Sunday morning, jumped out of bed, put on my best suit, got in my car and raced like a jet all the way to you. Walked in your church with heart in my hand to ask you a question, 'cause I know that you're a Calvinist friend. Yeah, can I question your doctrine without any strife? Say yes, 'cause I need to know. Say I'll never get your blessing till the day I die. Tough luck, my friend, but the answer is no. Why you gotta be so rude? Don't you know I'm Christian too? Why you gotta be so rude? I'm gonna question you anyway. Question too late. Question you anyway. Question too late. Yeah, no matter what you say. Question too late. Ain't what it ought to be. You gotta be so
hello, all my theology geek friends, to Sociology 101. Yes, I got to bring back the old, why you got to be so rude music anytime I'm responding to our friend, Dr. James White, because yes, he's a little cantankerous. Yes, he's a little mean, but he does a great job bringing out the differences between the provisionist and the Calvinist, sometimes by looking at positions that we don't hold to, strawmanning us, if you will. And that's part and parcel with not listening to responses, even at the very end of this broadcast that we're going to be responding to. James White admits he doesn't take the time to listen to the responses, and that's evident. He did this with our Ken Wilson response, where he said some things about Ken Wilson were just absolutely false about his beliefs based upon where he worked and other things. And then he comes onto the program and he explains, this is not my position. This is not the position I hold to. And therefore, you should not call me that or this. And then James White even comes out and says, I'm not going to take the time to listen to it because it's a distraction. And he goes on saying the exact same, making the exact same errors that he's made dozens of times before. And so that's why we do this, in order to correct those misnomers. But before we jump into this, I want to draw your attention to the app. That's actually a picture of my dog that my daughter put on my phone screen. But the app is something that I want you to see there. If you go to the App Store on Google Play or at the Apple Store, either one, you can find Sociology 101. Just search for Sociology 101. And you will find it. It is a great app to download. I appreciate Art. We talked about just two episodes ago or a couple of videos ago. Go back in the playlist and you can see more about his ministry and what he does. And if you're a small business owner looking for app development, you should look at Art's work. He is very, very good at what he does. And I will put more information on the show notes about him too. I didn't put that in there yet, and I need to go back and do that. So thanks for that reminder as well. And so make sure that you go and you download that app if you haven't already. And what I'm going to do here is I'm switching over my things to my earphones so that I can hear Dr. White as I respond to him. And so here's what we're going to do. We're going to go to the broadcast. This was just this was just a few days ago, 22 hours ago, so less than 24 hours ago. And we're going to go right here to the 6 minute mark or so, six minutes, 50 seconds. Let's put it that way. And I'm going to pull James White over here on the side. And what I want to do is he does a good long hour kind of rebuttal lead in before he actually starts playing my words. It's funny how Dr. White often critiques me for things that he himself is known for as well, and that is being a little bit long-winded. We both tend to go long on our programs, and so he goes a long time here. It's over an hour and a half program, And I'm going to try to be, I'm not even going to try. You guys, this is going to be long, guys. Okay. So listen to Double Speed if you want to wait and listen to it later. Listen to Double Speed later. You can do that. But this is going to take a while. And I think it will give a lot of really clear indications of how, as we as provisionists see John 10 in comparison to the way Calvinists do. So one of the reasons I like James White is because he doesn't beat around the bush. He comes out and says exactly what he believes. And it is very stark to see the things side by side when you see them. I wish he didn't do the straw manning stuff. I wish he didn't do the fallacious to the man type of arguments and one string banjos and Leighton Flowers never does anything except this and all those kinds of things. I wish all that stuff was aside. I wish he could treat me like he does Michael Brown, but we can't have everything we want, right? So we're going to take what we're given. And what we're given is a clear indication from a Calvinist vantage point of how they see John chapter 10 as comparison to how we see John chapter 10. And because it's such a long response, you guys go back and listen to my short. I've got a short 10-minute video on John chapter 10. Just type in Soteriology 101 at the Soteriology page and look for John 10, and you can find a short 10, less than 15-minute video on John chapter 10 from our perspective if you want to hear our side of things. And I encourage you to do that. Listen to both sides of the argument. I want you to understand what James White believes and thinks, because I don't want to straw man him. I want to steel man him. In other words, I want to think, what is the best possible thing he could mean by what he's saying here? Not what is the worst possible thing. Okay. That's unfortunately not what he does with me. I wish he did that with me. I wish he would look for my best arguments versus straw manning me and saying the same mistakes over and over again that I've already corrected him on dozens of times before. But that's just not what he chooses to do, because he has free will, and he chooses to use his free will to discredit other people by misrepresenting their views. And that's unfortunate, because we as Christians should have a higher standard, and we should do better at trying to represent other Christians in the best possible way. And so if on the side chat I'm watching it, if you think that I am strawmanning White, or if you think that I am misrepresenting Calvinism, please kind of tag me there. Let me see it. I want to try. I want to hear feedback. Notice he has his, it even says right there, live chat reply was turned off for this video. He doesn't listen to live chat on his videos. I do, because I want feedback. I don't want to be in an echo chamber. I want to listen to voices that are speaking. I want to hear your voice. And so please message me. If you think I'm misrepresenting you, please let me know that. So let's just dive right in. I'm going to be kind of jumping through this first hour in order to get as much in as possible. I'm playing them a little bit faster. We'll see how good I can do at getting even the first hour response in. Thank you, Dustin, for your donation, brother. Appreciate that.
This is 23 hours ago. Well, when I saved this. So it was right around the afternoon, noontime yesterday. Sent it to you, aomin.org, and it says, I know Dr. Oakley 1689, that's me, and Leighton Flowers react to each other's content a lot. Well, yeah, I suppose. We actually do all sorts of other topics, too.
Hello? There we go. I did a mistake there already.
Equation where you have a line of shepherds.
Okay. So, I messed up. Let me start.
Equation where you have a line of shepherds.
Okay. What he was saying there was he was reflecting on a interview I just did with 180, the 180 podcast that I promoted there at the website that y'all saw. And he's referring to her because she's a Calvinist, and she retweeted it and tweeted him in and said she's having some difficulty with my explanation of John 10 and was wondering if he could cover it. So that's basically what's going on here. And so he's reflecting on the fact, first of all, that he says, well, we the AO men, we cover a lot of different topics here, but Leighton Flowers only covers one. That's true. On Soteriology 101, I've created this one for this topic. Now, here at Texas Baptist, I do all my other ministries where I do evangelism, apologetics, and all kinds of things. People who follow this particular blog or podcast don't maybe know about that unless you actually use the internet to Google my name and look at other things that I do. But if you choose to only be tunnel visioned and say, okay, Leighton doesn't do anything else because all I know about him is what I saw on the YouTube page, that's just short-sightedness. And he's been corrected on this dozens of times, but he's not really interested, I don't think, in understanding those things. But nevertheless, we move on here.
And it's challenging. And so, yeah.
Go back here.
Well, yeah, I suppose. We actually do all sorts of other topics too, unlike Leighton. And you might be interested in his discussion of passages in John 6 and John 10, starting at about minute 43. To be quite honest, I found it challenging. And so, you know, I hesitated a moment and then I grabbed it. And then Kelly and I listened to it as we were driving to and from church, because it's a long ways across the valley to East Mesa from where we live. So plenty of time to listen to something. And there wasn't anything new. Certainly anyone who's familiar with Leighton Flowers and his quote unquote provisionism and the rather unique.
Okay. If my view is unique and nothing new, I'm not sure how you have both of those. Nothing new to him, I guess, because it's something that he's dealt with, then it should be able to be easily represented. In other words, if I'm saying the same thing over and over again, and you've heard it all before, you should be able to represent it well. And I haven't found that to be the case.
Perspectives that he presents is familiar with this, but given that Georgie Borman said, I found this challenging, I thought, well, all right, it's been a while. Let's crack open the Greek New Testament and let's deal with especially John chapter 10. That's a beautiful passage, gives us the opportunity of delving into it and then responding to what Leighton has to say. And so I would invite you to take your scriptures. For those of you who are not familiar, some of you may have been coming to watch The Dividing Line just over the past number of months, and so you've not seen this segment.
Okay, so let's talk about this first of all. Notice that he kind of makes the accusation, well, you know, the provisionists and our non-Calvinists, the Arminians, they have tons of different interpretations of John chapter 6, but not the Calvinists. I mean, we're consistent. Let me give you just one example of how this is just not the case. This is from Phil Johnson, who's a friend of James White. They've been on the same stage together a number of times. And notice what he says here in his discourse. This is a passage out from Phil Johnson, again, from Grace to You Ministries. He's the guy who works with John MacArthur. He says, second, don't imagine that there's just one view for limited atonement position, another view for unlimited position, as if they're just two polar opposites here. They're completely against each other. That's not really an either-or position, even among Calvinists. And in fact, historically, most of the intense debates about limited atonement have come over the last 400 years, and they've all been intramural debates between Calvinists, among Calvinists. There are at least three major divisions of Calvinists, and he goes on to describe that. And then he goes on in here, and he says, and when you get to individual verses, like 2 Peter 2, verse 1, there is no such thing as, quote, the Calvinistic interpretation of it. And if we have time, now he says, there is at least six, look at this, there is at least six possible Calvinistic interpretations of passages having to do with the atonement. And if he has time, he says he'll go through three of those, okay? So if you're under the delusion that, hey, Calvinists are just monolithic and they have this one standard interpretation of all of these texts and it's just the way that it works, then that's obviously not true. Now, I'm not sure White would go that far to say that. I'm just saying that I am trying to be, again, steelmanning, not strawmanning. And if he were not trying to strawman us or trying to make us look as bad as possible, then he would acknowledge the fact that we all have various views within our various camps. That is a proper way to address a fellow brother in Christ, to be honest, to be intellectually honest about your own perspective, to say, hey, you know what, well, you know, I take this view, but you know, Bruce Ware, he disagrees with me on this interpretation of 1 John 2:2, for example, or something like that. That would be a more intellectually honest and reasonable approach to a disagreement that you have with somebody. And that's not typically something we see as much from James White, unfortunately. Now, we see it from other Calvinistic friends that we've had on, and that's why I like to have Calvinistic friends on who do better represent, I think, the Calvinistic perspective in a fair way. James White's just not doing that, at least in this particular broadcast. Let me go ahead and move on a little bit forward. Again, just like I said, I'm going to skip around just a little bit here.
But then we started responding to some of the better people, some of the more in-depth topics.
And at least a good thing there, maybe he's including me in one of the better people, because he said he used to just do kind of in the Radio Free Geneva, just the bad stuff. And then he started to return better. Maybe he's calling, I got a compliment. Maybe I don't know.
I've forgotten how many different interpretations, for example, of John chapter 6 we have analyzed over the past. We started this, what, about 2004-ish? somewhere around there. So, you know, 15, 16 years, we've been doing Radio Free Geneva, and we've lost track, literally, of the number of interpretations that you could put together just simply from John chapter 6. That's not because there's anything unclear about John chapter 6. That's what we do, is we go through the text and demonstrate, well, see, they missed this here, they're incorrect about this, their assertion here misses that, whatever else it might be. But we...
Okay, that's all I wanted you to hear about that, just to show from what I showed from Phil Johnson, that there's obviously interpretations that vary from both perspectives. And that's a more fair, I think, balanced way of looking at that. Let's go to this next little section here. Okay, here we go.
And the Radio Free Geneva theme was with Leighton Flowers. And I asked him during our debate in 2015 in Dallas, are you basically using the same hermeneutical methodology? Are you interpreting scripture consistently in the same fashion when we look at the deity of Christ, the resurrection, inspiration of scripture, issues like this? Are you using a different methodology in your interpretation of Romans 9, your interpretation of passages relating to this particular subject, that you do when looking at other things? And basically said, well, yeah. I had asked, is this the same methodology? And he said, well, no. So he was saying, yeah, we use a different way of doing things. And that...
Okay, this is another one of those issues that's been corrected probably 1,000 times. I'm exaggerating. Okay, at least a dozen, maybe two dozen times. And some of which I know they're on videos that he's responded to. So I know he's seen the correction and he's choosing to ignore it. When he asked me about the methodology that I use, he was asking me about, in that 20-minute presentation, is this the methodology that you would use in confronting all of these other issues in order to do exegesis? And my answer was no. This was a 20-minute response contrasting my interpretation of Romans 9 with your interpretation of Romans 9. In other words, I was hitting on the points of contention. I came to my conclusions based upon my hermeneutical and exegetical work at home, which takes hours on end to do. In 20 minutes, I'm not giving you my exegetical commentary, my hermeneutical work. I'm giving you my conclusions, and I'm contrasting your view with my view in my 20-minute rebuttal or my 20-minute opener. I am not giving a full exegetical commentary. That was my answer. And he knows that's what I was attempting to explain. What he does is just take the word no and therefore says, okay, therefore Leighton doesn't believe you should use a consistent methodology of hermeneutics and exegesis. And that's just a lie. That's false. He knows that I don't believe that. He knows that we should use consistent exegetical processes in every verse. All the verses are exegeted the exact same way, with exact same hermeneutical process, the same hermeneutical process that I use to come to my conclusions about Romans chapter 9, by the way. He knows that, but he consistently plays that in his opener and continues to dole that out as if that was the winner of the debate because I admitted that I didn't do the same kind of exegesis when interpreting Romans 9 as I would with anything else, as if I said that. So again, he doesn't try to steel man me. He doesn't try to understand my perspective even after correcting him. He simply latches on to something he argued once and then ignores every other conversation that you have with the individual and just hyper-focuses on that one thing, ignoring any kind of conversation with the person that you're trying to have. That's just not good Christian behavior. It's not what you're supposed to do in interacting with people. Yet we continue to go through these things to help you to understand that in order for us to see the exegetical mistakes that the Calvinist makes, which are typically they're well-intending, they're trying to exegete John chapter 10, for example, correctly. They're trying to do the right thing. They mean well. I think James White actually means well. I think he really does believe he's doing the Lord's work by calling me out. I think he really does believe that. I think he really does think that God's, you know, calling him to call out people like Leighton Flowers, that, you know, provisionist over there who's distracting people, who is obviously doing what he's doing by God's decree, but nevertheless, we'll ignore that mysterious thing that I'm confronting the person who God decreed to do that thing. But that's a whole nother fun discussion that he loves when I point out. Okay, so let's go to 13:18 here and pick up right there.
Listen to what Leighton Flowers had to say about John chapter 10. I think it'd be a good idea for us to actually spend some time looking at John chapter 10. It is a tremendous text. And just as Leighton said, well, go to my website and get this, that, and the other thing. I, just a few years ago, preached through John chapter 10 and John chapter 11 as part of a sermon series on based on P45.
Okay. Now, notice a couple things he said there. Notice he said, he acknowledged that I said to, in that original podcast, speaking to Georgie, I said to her, now it would be better for you to go to my website and look at the materials that I've produced because you're interviewing me and this is going to be a very quick response. He even acknowledges that just now. And he even says it himself. I have stuff at my website you should go to. And then he's going to go through the verses himself. Now, this is the MO of James White. He will grab interviews that I've done, like on Unbelievable, like with this 180 podcast. He will grab those interviews, play those interviews, and say, look, Leighton does analogies. He doesn't do exegesis. Okay, so Leighton didn't do any exegesis to prepare for this interview, where he's giving a very short, quick answer, mostly to laymen, trying to explain using parables and analogies, much like his Lord did, Jesus, in order to help people to understand heavenly things in a more simple manner. So instead of, again, strawmanning me, why not steelman me and say, okay, Leighton's using analogy to explain his exegesis. Let's go to his website and pull in these exegetical commentaries that he recommends, the other things that he's done, where he's gone more in depth into these passages. Instead of doing that, what does he do? He just plays the little snippet from the thing and says, Leighton does this analogesis. This Leighton just doesn't do any exegesis. He just tells stories. Story time with Uncle Leighton. And instead of going to, he just acknowledged that I said to go to the website and look for the materials. He acknowledges, he even does it himself, but he doesn't allow for his opponent to have the same abilities to be able to refer to his materials offline. And again, that's just not a Christ-like way to respond to these kinds of things. I'm going to skip ahead to 15. I'm telling you all the timestamps in case you're following along and you want to see these things. 15:25 is where I'm going to jump up to here.
But he who enters by the door is a shepherd of the sheep. To him, the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. Now, don't have time to go into all of the very interesting background discussions. There have been many people who have gone and observed shepherding, especially as it's still practiced in the ways that it was in the days of Jesus. The common folds, the fact that shepherds would bring their flocks, and all of a sudden you've just got all these sheep in the same common fold. And yet the shepherd could then come having transacted his business, done whatever he needed to do, and would call his sheep by name, and his flock would come out of the rest that were in the common pen where they would be being held. So they know his voice. To him, the doorkeeper opens and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. And so there is an intimate relationship that exists, but it's obvious, I would think, that sheep.
Okay. So there's an intimate relationship that exists. Let's think about that for a second. Okay. Notice, first of all, he says, we don't have a lot of time to go into detail. So in other words, go to my website, look at the more detailed stuff, which is what you should do also with me. Here, let's ask the question. Why do they know his voice? Do they know his voice because they were born knowing his voice already? Would the Calvinists say that? Because we're still manning him. We're not going to straw man him. Okay. So let's ask that question legitimately. Do Calvinists believe that people are born fallen, under wrath, depraved, God haters, children of the devil? Yes, they do. That's what total depravity is. You're redeemed, before you're born again, you are a hater of God. But yet he says that sheep means that you're in an intimate relationship with God. So are you already born into an intimate relationship with God, and that's why you can hear his voice? Because we know they're not born already in an intimate relationship. Calvinists don't teach that. So we can't assume that he thinks that people are born with this already intimate relationship with the Father. Is it because the sheep have some supernatural thing happen to them at some time in their life where they automatically just start listening to one particular shepherd's voice? Or in the analogy that Jesus has used, why do sheep listen to their shepherd's voice? Is it because they have learned it over time by listening to it? That makes sense, right? Okay, so the reason a sheep hears a voice is not because of a natural condition that he's born with. It's not because of some supernatural zapping that happens to him when, like, a butterfly comes out of its shell, then all of a sudden it flies. Now there's some kind of time the sheep metamorphoses, you know, supernaturally and just becomes something new where he automatically listens to this voice of the sheep. So neither one of those work. So it's not they're born that way. And it's not that some supernatural thing just happens to them, making them listen to the voice of their shepherd. So what's the third option? They listen to the voice of the shepherd. They learn from the shepherd. And they learn to hear his voice. Just like any other pet. I got two dogs in my house. And this one right over here, she knows my voice. Because she's learned to listen to my voice over time, right? That's what animals do. They listen and they learn. And once they listen and learn, they recognize the voice of their shepherd. Okay. So on our perspective, we believe that God speaks the same thing as his son does, because guess what? They're one, which is a theme of throughout the book of John, is that everything that Jesus speaks, he's only speaking what he's been told to speak by the Father, because everything he says is exactly the same thing as the Father said. If you believed in Abraham, you'd believe in me because he spoke of me. Everything is from the Father. And therefore, if you have listened and learned from the Father, if you have been paying attention to the scriptures, if you have been growing in the Father and knowing him, you're going to recognize the Father's voice when it's spoken through the Son. That's our interpretation. Now, does James White really represent that interpretation very well? I don't think so. And for him to conclude here that there's an intimate relationship that exists because one is a sheep, then that would preclude, or I think that would avoid your interpretation that sheep equals unconditionally elect ones, because that's the way he's interpreting the word sheep ultimately to mean here. He's ultimately saying the reason you don't believe the Father, the reason you don't believe me, he's saying, is because you're not elect, because you're not chosen. You're not one of the ones who belong to me, who I chose before the foundation of the world. And yet he says the word sheep means those who have an intimate relationship with the Father. You're not born with an intimate relationship with the Father. You get an intimate relationship with the Father upon faith, upon belief. Even on the Calvinistic system, you have that. And so it simply doesn't work, even from the Calvinistic interpretation, it simply doesn't work to say that the word sheep here is somehow speaking of an intimate relationship with the Father, but it also means chosen before the foundation of the world unconditionally. You can't have it both ways, James. You can't have your cake and eat it too here. Either sheep means the elect, chosen before the foundation of the world unconditionally, or sheep is referencing to those who listen and learn from the Father and have an intimate relationship with him and recognize him. So which is it? I actually agree with what you just said. Sheep does indicate an intimate relationship with the Father, and therefore you would listen to the Son. But you don't believe that. So why would you say that sheep have an intimate relationship with the Father? That's not your interpretation of the word sheep. He makes this mistake about five times throughout his discourse. He doesn't even recognize it. That's why I want him to come on the show. I've asked him to come on the show. I've said, I'll go on your show if you'd rather. I even talked to the 180 podcast people. I tweeted them today and said, bring us both on and let's just talk through this, because I would like him to explain to me how sheep can equal both unconditionally elected people and those in intimate relationship with God. How can it be both? How can Jesus mean both when saying the word sheep? It simply doesn't make sense. Okay, we're moving on.
Do not choose shepherds. You do not have a situation where you have a line of shepherds and the sheep are paraded by, and the sheep, you know, look over each shepherd and a little bit tall, a little bit swarthy. No, I'm not doing that one. This one.
Okay. Shepherds also don't pick sheep unconditionally before they're ever born, James White. So if you're going to hyper criticize the analogy of Jesus, you can hyper criticize it for the Calvinistic view too. In other words, shepherds don't just say, hey, I'm going to just pick some sheep before he's ever born. He doesn't do that either. Shepherds usually go to a pen and pick out the sheep that are choice. Right. That's usually the way it happens, which we'll get into in just a minute. Which, by the way, that's not my analogy. It's Jeremiah 24 analogy. We'll get to that a little bit later.
Good. I'm gonna. Behind all of this would be the rather obvious reality that the shepherd is in charge of the sheep, that the shepherd chooses the sheep. The shepherd leads the sheep wherever the shepherd wants to take the sheep. The shepherd's in control of the shepherd-sheep relationship. And even when a sheep is lost, as in some of the parables of Jesus, this is because sheep are not the brightest creatures God ever placed upon his planet. I've never seen...
Yeah, we agree with all of that, but the difference between our two perspectives is that we don't believe that sheep are being deterministically micromanaged by the shepherd either, and therefore to call sheep dumb is ultimately to call the one who is decreeing their every action and desire dumb. And who are you to question God in that way? Who are you to question that God decrees his sheep to be dumb? It doesn't make a lot of sense. Now, on my perspective, I can say that and mean it, and it makes a lot more sense because I'm ultimately saying, yeah, the creature who is acting separately from the Father and doing his own thing and sinning and denying God and doing all this stuff, he's not doing what God's ultimately decreed him to do through exhaustive divine determinism. He is doing what he does freely, and therefore he's blameworthy for all that dumb stuff that he does.
A relative IQ analysis of sheep over against other animals, but I don't think they'd do well if we somehow figured out exactly how to do that and compare it with others. I think they'd be really down toward the bottom quarter of commensurate wildlife, shall we say? And so it's very, very plain, very, very obvious that it is the shepherd who chooses the sheep, the shepherd that is in charge of the sheep, the shepherd is the one who defines his flock. This can become important because one of the elements of Leighton Flowers' presuppositional methodology of getting around just doing straight exegesis is he is going to, again, as he always does, utilize analogies to introduce parameters into the text that are not in the text initially. And so what we're going to get here is that the sheep in Jesus' context are actually Jews who have shown themselves to be more godly than other Jews.
No, Jews who follow the Father. It's really that simple. God-fearing Jews. That's not hard. You can try to make it sound as ridiculous as you want to, but again, you're strawmanning versus steelmanning me. It's people who listen and learn from the Father. It's what the scriptures talk about. Let's just look at the context of what the scriptures themselves say real quick, Dr. White, and don't let me forget to bring him back in when I start playing it again. Verse 45 of John chapter 6, it is written in the prophets, and they shall be taught of God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me, the Son. Okay? Comes to me. He's speaking of the Son there. Okay? So what is the criterion for those who come to the Son? Those who listen and learn from, in other words, those who have an intimate relationship, what he interprets sheep to mean, those who have intimate relationship with the Father, what are they going to do when the Son, who's speaking the exact same thing the Father speaks, when he shows up on scene and he begins to speak, what are they going to do? They're going to go, oh, I recognize that voice because I've been listening and learning from it. I recognize because he's speaking the exact same thing. I read from Abraham and Abraham said these things. And before Abraham was, Jesus was. Jesus is, says, I am in John chapter 8. This is a theme throughout the book of John where he consistently brings back the narrative of God the Father and Jesus the Son are one. They speak the same thing. They speak with one voice. Therefore, if you know God's voice, what will you do when the Son speaks? You'll know his voice. You'll listen and learn from it. Doesn't that make sense? Doesn't it make so much more sense than the idea or concept that God just rejects people before they're ever born for no apparent reason? Just arbitrarily pick some people and not others? Of course it does. You all know it does. This is the reason James White and so many others are pushing back against this so hard. It's because it's just way too reasonable. I think it's the reason he wouldn't debate me on John chapter 10 if I begged him to. Matter of fact, there's the offer. I would love to debate you on John chapter 10. Name the time and place. Let's do that. Would love to debate you. And by the way, I won't hold you to the same standards you held me to and confine you to one chapter. I'll let you go anywhere you want to help you explain what John chapter 10 means. Be fine with me because I think exegesis includes a full range hermeneutic of looking at the context, the historical context of whatever passage that you happen to be dealing with. So that would be great. I would love to have that discussion. Oh, let me put it back in here.
To the Almost voice of Jesus's Father. So in other words, these are obedient Jews. These are the Jews who are obedient to God's word that has come from the Father. And because they've listened to the Father, then they follow the Son. And so he wants to place, as he has to, his is a very man-centered, totally man-centered idea when it comes to...
Okay, whose ever theology is wrong is man-centered. Okay, so it's question begging to call the other person man-centered. If John Calvin is wrong, and he created a systematic way of thinking about the Bible that's centered around his particular theology, then that's man-centered. And plus, I can make a pretty strong argument that thinking that God picked you individually, James White, before you even existed, like you're a pre-existent thing that God just had to pick you, and just that seems pretty self-centered, and if you put it that way, right? I don't think that it works that way. I think I can make Calvinism sound pretty me-centered, pretty I'm the elect-centered. I can make it sound like that. And so whichever theology is the wrong theology, that's the man-centered theology, because it's based upon a theology made by man, not true God-centered theology. I've said this before, when he's called me man-centered theology, I've always just said, yeah, I agree. It's centered on the man, Jesus Christ. We have a very Christocentric soteriology. And the Christocentric soteriology is one who's focused on a God who lays down his life for the enemy, not one who passes over his enemy, not one who passes by the other side of the road like the Levite and the priest, but one who actually, like the Samaritan, stops and helps his enemies. That's a Christocentric soteriology. It's one who provides because provision is good. One who provides is good. And therefore, we believe God is recognizably good because he actually provides for his enemies. He doesn't just step on his enemies to make himself look better, as the Calvinistic system ultimately has him ultimately sacrificing most of humanity in order to make himself more glorified. We think instead that God's most glorified in the sacrifice for himself for the sake of humanity. And so he sacrifices himself for his enemies. He's not glorified by the control over his enemies. He's glorified by his love and provision for his enemies. That's the distinction between our two worldviews.
How the identity of the saved and the lost is determined. It's all of man. It is not of God. God tries to save everybody, but he cannot. It's up to man.
Okay, so that's again straw manning. We're not trying to say God's trying to save everybody and just can't, okay? That's a straw man representation of what we believe. We've always said that God could do whatever he wants to. If he wants to do things universal, like the universal says, and absolutely irresistibly effectually saves everybody in some way, he could do it that way. If he wants to do it Calvinistically, where he picks and chooses certain people and effectually saves some people and damns the rest, he could do it that way. God can do whatever he wants to do. That's not the debate. The debate is, what has he chosen to do? God has the right to rule however he pleases to rule. But what does the Bible say he has chosen to do in this situation? Has he chosen to give us real choice versus a world of puppets where he pulls the strings and we respond based upon the response of the creatures? Now, I understand that Calvinists think that's a straw man when we talk about puppeteering, but oftentimes Calvinists, when talking about Romans 9, use the potter clay analogy as if the clay is just an inanimate object being acted upon and they're completely passive. And therefore, if you're going to take biblical analogies in the same way as the puppet analogy would ultimately dictate, then you can't really get too mad at us if you're going to interpret the clay potter analogy in such a way as the pot really has no more control over his shape than a puppet has over his movement in the hand of a puppet master. Then I'm just saying, if you're going to own it, own it. If you don't want that view to be accredited to your perspective, then you probably shouldn't interpret Romans 9 and other passages to mean exhaustive divine determinism, because the puppet analogy is, I think, reflective of more of an exhaustive divine deterministic perspective, where ultimately God is deciding what you will decide in any given situation.
Man. And so it is totally and completely in the human realm, even more so, and he did in this interview, even more so than in the Arminian perspective, because in the Arminian perspective, you have prevenient grace. And at least in the Arminian perspective, that's an actual exercise of supernatural power. Now, I would say prevenient grace is to be found nowhere in Scripture. It is a complete misunderstanding of what grace, the power of grace in Scripture. But at least...
Okay, this is his attempt to play me against the Arminian to say, ultimately, hey, the Arminians are wrong. Prevenient grace is nowhere to be taught. And Leighton doesn't teach prevenient grace anyway. But at least they agree with us that people are born Lazarus-like dead and can't do anything until they're brought to partial life, at least. So at least they've got that going for them. And we've covered this on enough broadcasts to understand that we do believe in a prevenient, meaning the basic meaning of the word, grace that is needed beforehand. I mean, even Calvinists believe in prevenient grace. They just believe the prevenient grace is effectual and it's only given to the elect. So it's particular and it's effectual. The Arminian says that it's given to everybody and it's not effectual. And therefore they have the ability to respond. And all we would say is, let's just take out prevenient grace and let's put in biblical words here. What's the biblical word? Gospel, revelation, light. These are biblical words. And those graces of God are sufficient. So if somebody hears the truth, because it is a double-edged sword, because it pierces not through just bone and marrow, but through soul and spirit, the word has power. The word is truth. Truth sets you free. If you suppress it, it won't set you free. If you accept it, it will set you free. The Bible is not shy about giving power to the words of God. And therefore, I don't have a problem saying that the words of God are the sufficient works of grace needed for us to believe. How will they believe in one whom they never heard? Well, that seems to imply that if they do hear, they may believe. So why do some people refuse and some people accept? That's their responsibility. That's their ability to respond. Same answer that you would give to as why did Adam and Eve choose to sin when given a choice? It's their choice. It's their responsibility. The cause of a choice is the chooser. The cause of an action is the actor. And I don't take it beyond that by assuming determinism upon it and by saying, well, the reason they did that must be because of some effectual grace on one side or from some natural decree on the other side by which they couldn't have done otherwise, because that removes their blameworthiness. And it also undermines, I think, the well-meant offer of the gospel for all creatures.
The Arminians understood enough about biblical anthropology, understood enough about what Jesus taught and what the apostles taught about the deadness of man and sin, which is not an inability to respond to God. It is an inability to submit to God. Mankind in a state of spiritual deadness.
Now, this is one of the reasons that I always talk about respond positively. The word I use the word positively. And again, if James White ever took the time to listen to any of my responses, he would know that I corrected this. He says he just thinks I'm just completely misrepresenting Calvinism because I use the word respond. I always say respond willingly or respond positively because I'm clarifying that the response is either positive or negative. And sometimes we just say the word respond in a quick vernacular, and he'll latch on to that where, oh, he said, oh, the natural man can't respond to God. And therefore he goes, no, they can respond. They will always respond negatively. Well, then that's not a response. That's a instinctive reflex, in my opinion. But if you want to call it response, fine. I'll just put in the word positively so as to not be accused of misrepresenting you anymore. And that's one of the reasons I consistently use the word positively, but he doesn't recognize that I've made that correction several times.
His response to God, but he does so negatively by suppressing the knowledge of God.
And why does he suppress the knowledge of God? On your view, because God decreed for him to, by the way he was born according to the fall of Adam. In other words, because Adam fell, God punished all of humanity by making them unable to do anything except suppress truth when they hear it. Now, they don't have to suppress all truth, just biblical truth. They can believe George Washington was president, for example. That's truth. They can believe that. They can even believe lies. They can believe the Quran. They can believe that. They just can't believe the Bible. Why? That's the way God just decreed it. That's a punishment from the fall, I guess. And therefore, they just can't do it unless God gives them a new nature, making them able to stop suppressing truth. And again, where's it? It doesn't exist. It's not there. Now, we go over some of the proof texts they use to try to support that or prop that up. But again, I don't find that supported anywhere in the pages of Scripture.
Again, Leighton presents himself as a former Calvinist. The people who knew him during that period of time go, really? We didn't notice it.
Okay, and he's never named names here about people who knew me formerly. But remember, in my other world, the world he doesn't know anything about, I was a director of youth evangelism for 13 years, where I oversaw the youth evangelism conferences and see you at the poll and Super Summer Ministries, tens of thousands of people work with me who are a part of our staff, okay? Many of which I would have trainings with and I was working with through a lot of that time. Prior to that, I worked in youth ministry settings at churches, those kinds of things. You deal with a lot of people and you work with a lot of people. Very few of them you work with an intimate kind of relationship ways. And he probably, my guess is somebody who worked with me during the Super Summer years, which were actually more the years when I was coming out or already out of Calvinism, probably knew somebody from those time periods that have used me as an in-rut with James White. Like, well, I used to work with Leighton Flowers and I can tell you this, and then gives him something, right? And they know nothing about me. And so if he would like to mention to me, maybe if you want to private message me the name of the person who's telling him these things, then I can give some context of who that might be. But just imagine if Michael Brown or someone else that James White deals with regularly were to come on and say, oh, I knew somebody who used to work with James White back in the day who said this about him and then never named a name, never gave any context of those things. He wouldn't want people to do that to him. So what's the old golden rule? Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. James White wouldn't want anybody doing that to him. We shouldn't do it to James White, and he shouldn't be doing it to others. So again, I'm going to call out bad behavior when I see it, because I don't want you modeling this. This is a bad example of the way to disagree with those from the other side.
And this comes out in his repetitious misrepresentation of Reformed theology and saying, well, they just believe that mankind cannot respond to God.
No, so his one example of my totally misrepresenting Calvinism is one time a long time ago in a video where he snatched it out where I said that people are born unable to respond to God, when obviously I meant unable to respond positively to God's appeals, right? And I have clarified that. I have brought correction to that dozens of times, many of which ones he's actually played on his actual program, so he knows better. But again, this is what James White does. He'll latch on to something I've said once, he locks that into his brain, and ignores anything that comes later that might have to do with correction to the point that he made. And therefore, you can't grow in your dialogue with someone who continues to do that. And that's what we're trying to push James White to start doing. Start listening to the people you oppose, start hearing them out, be reasonable, be rational, hear them out, and then reflect on what you've heard, and then don't make that same mistake over and over again by saying the same thing that you said before.
And responds to God all the time, always negatively, as a slave to sin. That's the whole point. It's not that he's just a corpse sitting there doing nothing. There is a negative response. It is a suppression. This is well known. Anyone who was once Reformed would know this. But anyway, so the important thing here is that Leighton wants to, by analogy, bring in the presupposition that sheep choose the shepherd, and that sheep are sheep by their own nature. They are the good people rather than the goats. And that's because they listen. They're listening to the fathers. That means they're obedient to the Old Testament scriptures. And now Jesus comes along, then they are going to be hearing Jesus' voice versus they heard the Father's voice. That's not anywhere in John 10. There's nothing where sheep heard one shepherd's voice and then there's a new shepherd, but that shepherd speaks the same words and therefore they follow that shepherd.
What? Y'all listening to that? I'm not going to be mean. Okay. All right. God, the Son. God, the Father. God, the Son. Okay. God, the Father, during the Old Testament times, that's how he was revealed. It's God, the Father. Cornelius believed in God, the Father, feared the Lord. Okay. Worshiped the Lord. Did he know who Jesus of Nazareth was? No. Didn't know anything about the Son yet. Okay. So he listens and learns from the Father, has an intimate relationship with the Father, prays to the Father, follows the Father, in a love relationship with the Father. The Father gives him to the Son by bringing him Peter from Joppa. So he knows about the Son. He can believe and follow the Son. So this thing about two shepherds? No, of course there's one shepherd. It's God the Father, represented by the triune nature of God. You've written a book on the Trinity, so James White, I know you understand that, right? That it's one shepherd, three persons, okay? Father, Son, Holy Spirit. The Father's voice, if you listen and learn from it, then you would hear the Son's voice, because guess what? Triune nature of God, they're one voice. So this whole thing about John chapter, nothing about two shepherds here. What this shepherd thing was, I don't even know what he's talking about. It's just ridiculous. What is he doing? Strawmanning our position versus understanding, I think, what he knows based upon what he goes on to say later in this program. He knows what I'm saying. Those who listen and learn from the Father, they will listen to the Son. That makes sense. Again, you don't. The only reason you would strawman and paint your opponent in this horrible of a light is if you were scared of people actually understanding what he's saying for fear that they might actually listen to him and believe what he's saying. And that's what I say. I think we're seeing here. James White knows what I'm saying is very reasonable. So he has to paint it as, I believe in these two separate shepherds, and these sheep, are just trying to decide which shepherds are going to follow and all these kinds of things, versus understanding that there is one shepherd, God, who is our shepherd, who speaks through the voice of the Father, and he speaks the same voice through the voice of the Son. And that's obviously what I'm saying, but that's not obviously what he wants to represent me as saying. So let's skip ahead. We're going to go to 28, the 28:30 mark here. So bear with me. Here we go.
Please, because he is a hired hand, is not concerned about the sheep. I am the good shepherd. In contrast to that, I know my own and my own know me. And so I am the good shepherd. Ta Emma are simply the ones of me, so my own. And Ta Emma, those ones who I own, know me as well. So there is a personal, intimate relationship that exists between the sheep and the shepherd.
Did you hear that? There's an intimate personal relationship between the sheep and the shepherd. So before people believe, they're sheep on Calvinism, right? You're sheep before you believe, because in order to believe, you have to be a sheep first, in the way they've interpreted John chapter 10, right? So you have to be a sheep before you have faith. Therefore, you have to have an intimate personal relationship with God before you have faith in him. Can you explain that? Any of the Calvinists on the side chat, can you explain that? How is it that people have an intimate personal relationship before they have faith in God? Can anybody explain that? This is the reason I don't think he'll ever debate me on John chapter 10. I don't think he'll come onto the show on the 180 podcast. I dare him to, if that works. Sometimes that works with people. If you dare them, you know, double dog dare them. Okay. I would love that to happen, because people would see side by side clarity and compassion with cordiality, clarity. People listen and learn from the Father. They hear the Son's voice. They recognize the Son's voice because they're used to knowing what his voice sounds like, and they come to him. They believe in him. Because sheep means follower, not unconditionally chosen people before the foundation of the world. It's that simple. So which is more absurd? Which is more weird? Which is more strange? Believing that sheep means follower, which is what it means to all of us when we hear the word sheep, what do we think of? Oh, that sheep, he's a follower. That's basic common sense. Or does it mean unconditionally elected before the foundation of the world? That's what the Calvinists interpret, like John Piper did in the video that we went over this the first time with John Piper, right? So James here is not interpreting the word sheep to equal elect unconditionally before the foundation of the world. All of a sudden, he's jumping to our interpretation. Sheep means intimate relationship. Well, how does one have an intimate relationship with somebody they don't believe in and haven't listened and learned from yet? I agree with you, James White. Sheep does mean they have an intimate relationship, one they developed by listening and learning from the Father. Therefore, they would believe in the Son. See, the Calvinist has ignored the category of the New Testament times, of the shift from those who were God-fearing people to those who have become, under the grace of the gospel of Christ, through the redemptive work of Calvary. There's a shift that takes place here. And that shift is from those who go from God-fearers, those who follow out of obligation and law, and they're serving the Father, but they don't know of the Son yet. They don't know of grace yet. They don't know of the Spirit coming and dwelling in their life yet. And there's a shift that takes place from people like Simeon and Cornelius and others who I've mentioned, who are God-fearing people, who genuinely love God, but they don't know the Son yet. They don't know the story fulfilled through Christ of redemption. If that was a common known thing, they never would have crucified the Lord of glory, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 2:8-9. So there's a reason that they don't understand and know these things. They were hidden from their eyes, according to the scriptures. And so there's a good reason for these things being hidden. So follow these things clearly, and hopefully it will help. I want to skip down. I want to skip now quite a bit. I'm going to go all the way to the 41 minute mark, 41:20, for those who are writing these things down and your detailers that like to know things. There you go. 41:20. Here we go.
The only way this works, you see, no one in that day would have brought a Western individualistic methodology of interpretation.
When he said that, I almost fell down. I was walking in the park. It was one of those things I was going, okay, who has the Western individualized hermeneutic? The people who interpreted John chapter 10 the way that I do, which basic Eastern Orthodox does, and all of the earliest church fathers did, has nothing to do with the people in the Western world are the only people who contain Calvinists. And the only people who are Calvinistic are the ones who are individualized, Westernized. That, to me, I was just like, he can't even see himself in his own reflection while he's critiquing this. It was just baffling to me. Okay. Let me back up and we can restart that because I kind of interrupted him. All right, here we go.
No one in that day would have brought a Western individualistic methodology of interpretation.
Amen.
To the idea of the sheep
doing
and shepherd.
Amen. You should stop doing that.
It would have never crossed anyone's mind that the sheep are autonomous, that the sheep are...
Of course sheep are autonomous. The shepherd's not like with a leash on them telling them, okay, you're going to eat this grass here and you're going to eat that grass there and you're going to do that. Of course sheep are autonomous. Autonomous just means separate. I mean, it's the word autonomous is just the backside of the coin holy. God is holy, meaning he's separate than. He is perfect. He is righteous. Humanity, creatures, world, other than. Autonomous. We make our own choices. We are separate from the Father. We do our own thing. So when the sheep is eating grass, he's eating grass autonomously. It doesn't mean that the shepherd doesn't know he's eating grass. It doesn't mean the shepherd's not allowing him to eat the grass. It doesn't mean the shepherd couldn't stop him from eating the grass if he wanted to. It's like Jonathan Pritchett says a lot. I love Jonathan Pritchett. He says things so clear and concise, and he can say things and get away with saying things that I never could get away with. He says, guys, free will is not a superpower. Okay. It's not like we're trying to say the sheep is more powerful than the shepherd and that he's going to overtake the shepherd or he's going to, you know, free will is not a superpower. Okay. The sheep can do a lot of things all by himself, but that doesn't mean the shepherd can't knock him over the head if he wants to and kill him or whatever he wants to do. The shepherd's still sovereign over the sheep. He can do whatever he wants to. Sovereign doesn't mean to meticulously control your flock. It means to do as you will with your flock. And if you want to lead it off a cliff, hey, your prerogative. You want to lead it off a cliff. If you wanted to lead them into green pastures to enjoy the waters, the streams, then that's your prerogative as the shepherd to lead your sheep where you want them to go. That's what sovereignty means.
Sheep based upon personal merit, that they chose to be God's sheep over against something else. And when it says, but you do not believe because you are not of my sheep, what Leighton's system does is turns that.
Okay, so follow what he just now said there. I was looking for my notes where I kind of outlined this portion. Notice what he does, okay? Remember, for a Calvinist, faith is merit. Unless it's unconditionally, irresistibly given to the elect, it's meritorious on anything but Calvinism. So if you're not a Calvinist, then you have to this idea that faith in God is meritorious. Okay. Making sure I said that correct. Cause apparently I've been saying it wrong sometimes. Meritorious. Okay. And this is the fault line of Calvinism. Believing in God, even if it's done freely, doesn't merit anything. It just doesn't. That's just a fact of the matter. It's objectively true from our perspective. We don't believe faith merits anything. If it did, then Jesus wouldn't have needed to die. We could just say, okay, when you believe, you merit your salvation. What would Jesus need to die for, right? Abraham believed, and he was declared righteous by the merit of his faith. That's what the scripture would say. Instead, what does the scripture say? Abraham believed, and it was credited to him the righteousness of Christ. So, in other words, what is given to Abraham's account? The righteousness of Christ, the atoning work of Christ is placed over the top of Abraham because Abraham is fallen. He is sinful. He believed That's not a meritorious work. Okay, that's not something that earns salvation. When the tax collector falls and says, "Woe is me, I'm a sinner, have mercy on me," he's not earning anything by doing that. He's just confessing that he can't earn anything. He's confessing that you can't merit your salvation does not merit your salvation. Let me say that again. Confessing that you cannot merit your salvation, even if you confess that freely, from our perspective, does not in and of itself merit your salvation. If it did, there would be no reason for atonement. There would be no reason for the merit of Christ and his work and his blood. So again, it's a straw man tactic that Calvinists will use to say that the quote unquote sheep are meriting their salvation by believing in God the Father. And that's just not the way it is. Versus what they would say is, oh, in other words, in order for it to be meritorious, the only way it can be non-meritorious is if it's unconditionally selected before the foundation of the world and irresistibly caused to have faith, then it would be non-meritorious. And again, maybe your opinion, but you have to actually support that with the Bible, because the Bible never does this. The Bible always contrasts faith with works. It doesn't ever include faith as just one of the works that we can't do. So your problem is with Paul, not with, you know, the provisionist or with Leighton and directly. Let's continue on here.
Upside down. Because you choose not to believe, you are not my sheep. That's not what Jesus said. See how trying to force a God-centered text through a man-centered sieve results in a royal mess, a truly royal mess. What Jesus says is, but you do not believe because you are not of my sheep. So the whole...
Right. So you don't believe because you haven't listened and learned from the Father. You don't believe because you don't have an intimate relationship with me, which is what he interpreted sheep to mean earlier. So yeah, that's right. You don't believe because you don't have a relationship with me. You don't believe because you're not a follower of God. You don't believe in Jesus because you're not a follower of God. That's that simple. He's already conceded this point, guys. He's already conceded that sheep means intimate relationship with somebody. Okay. So if sheep means has an intimate relationship with somebody, that fits my definition, not his. Because on his view, sheep should mean unconditionally elected before the foundation of the world and irresistibly given the gift of faith so that they become believers so that they can have an intimate relationship with the Father at some time after becoming believers, okay, becoming followers of God. So you're not born already. A sheep is already born with an intimate relationship with the Father, even on Calvinism. So this is the reason that he continues to make this error over and over again. And I'm wondering, surely some of the Calvinist listeners to his program picked up on this. I would have to think there's people who picked up on his mistake there. At least I would hope that they would.
Idea that, well, they're sheep because they were the better Jews who were already listening to the Father. And because they were listening to the Father.
See, there it goes with the meritorious thing there. So if you listen and learn from the Father, if you believe in the Father, then you're automatically meritoriously better than the other people. And on our view, that's just not true, because those other people could do the exact same thing as these people are. In other words, ontologically, there's no difference between these people. Both of them have the ability to listen and learn from the Father, and they could listen and learn from the Father. And therefore, I can't say one of them is, quote, ontologically or made into better people with better stuff than other people were, on my view. He can say that on his view, because ultimately, the sheep are the ones who are given some kind of new nature, causing them to desire to believe truth, where these other people over here were born with a nature that always hates truth for reasons beyond their control. And so ontologically speaking, the sheep or the elect ones on Calvinism are better than the non-sheep by definition. So it's interesting that Calvinists accuse us of saying that one's better than the other, when it's really Calvinism that says the elect are better than the non-elect, because the elect are made into better creatures through a work of irresistible grace or regeneration, causing their nature to be that which is able to do something that the guys who were born in their natural state couldn't have done.
Then they choose to follow Jesus too. That's not what he says. When talking to unbelievers, he doesn't say, all you have to do is start following the Father, and then you'll start following me, and you'll become my sheep. He says, you do not believe because you are not of my sheep.
Now notice when he says believe, he automatically says, he makes that as believing in the gospel of Jesus Christ, the personal work of Jesus Christ, believing in Jesus as the Son of God. And he's not differentiating between that and believing in God, the Father. As the people in that day, there were people who believed in God the Father, like Cornelius prior to Peter's coming, believed in God the Father, but did not believe in the Son yet. He's not even thinking in those categories. He doesn't even entertain that there might be people who believe in the Father who don't yet know the Son. And unless you enter into that category of thinking, you can't understand this, because believing just means believing unto salvation. And that's all it's about. And I can't have any nuance of, hey, these are people who believed in the Father, but didn't yet know who the Son was yet. You can't have that kind of nuance, because it ruins the Calvinistic system, and you don't want to conflate the simple line of the tulip. And so we'll just ignore that. We'll put that off the side and accuse our, opponents of all kinds of stuff, except for what they're actually trying to say.
Again, we're jumping into the middle of a text, Gospel of John. Back in John 8:43. Jesus had said, the reason you do not understand what I'm saying is because you don't belong to God.
Right. So are you born belonging to God? The reason you don't understand, listen, James, please, if you're listening to this, I don't think he will. He says he won't. James White fans, listen, okay? If you didn't listen to the Father, you refuse to listen to the Father, and then the Son comes and he speaks the same thing, what are you going to do? You're going to continue not to listen to the Father. Are you born already belonging to the Father? The Bible teaches you're born as you often quote, Calvinists quote Ephesians 2, children of wrath, under our father, the devil, okay? Under Adam, fallen, corrupt, all those things. You're not born belonging to God, are you? Are you? Is that what you believe? You believe that people are born belonging to God? People are born in an intimate relationship with God from the beginning? Or do they become followers? Do they belong to him because they love him and have a relationship with him? Isn't that what scripture says? What is it? 1 Corinthians 8:3, that says, if anyone loves God, he is known by him. In other words, it has to do with a relationship, that you're known and you belong to him. He, the reason you're owned by the Father, or you're in the Father's possession, is because you enter into him through faith, not placed arbitrarily into him before the foundation of the world for reasons we don't know. That's never said in scripture.
You don't belong to God. His words were foreign to them, and there was a fundamental reason for that. And this is a biblical theme. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, the Apostle Paul says, the message of the cross is to them, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. There's an intimate relationship.
There it is again. See, my sheep have an intimate relationship. So these people, before they believe, have an intimate relationship. James, that's our interpretation, not yours. Okay? Gosh, I wish he would debate this. You can't say that the sheep have an intimate relationship if he's saying to them, the reason you don't believe is because you're not my sheep. Because if sheep have intimate relationship, then you're ultimately saying that sheep have an intimate relationship prior to believing. And that's not your position. That's my position. I believe people have an intimate relationship with the Father. Therefore, they believe in the story and of the gospel from the Son, where they believe in Christ, the Son. I'm the one who says that. You can't say that. You have just given up the debate. Okay. We could probably stop right there. As he likes to say, the debate is over right there. It's over. But we'll continue on. He gets into the remnant in chapter 11, who refused to bow a knee to Baal. He gets into the choice meats comment again. I'm trying to get through faster. I'm struggling here, guys, because there's so much, and I don't want to be.
What would be the natural understanding of both John 6 and John 10 when you have the Father giving a people unto the Son? When you follow through with the Old Testament prophetic narrative, it is very clear that God has an elect people, a remnant. And that remnant becomes more and more important the later you get in the Old Testament narrative, especially after the destruction of Jerusalem. And but even before them, what does Yahweh say to the prophet when the prophet's like, I'm the only one left, and cool it, dude. I've got 7,000. I have reserved to myself 7,000 who have not bowed the knee to Baal. He didn't go.
Okay. I've reserved for myself 7,000 who have refused to bow a knee to Baal. Okay. So the way, steel man, not straw man, our opponent. The way I think James White is interpreting is to say that because God reserved them through effectual means, through some kind of irresistible grace, you regenerated these 7,000 people, causing them to have faith in God. And therefore, they refuse to bow a knee to Baal. Okay? The text doesn't say any of those things, but that's the way he's interpreting it. Okay? Now, how would I interpret it? Let's steel man my side too. So we want the best of both sides because you want to hear both sides. Okay? So the remnant are those who have refused to bow a knee to Baal. God's reserved. We know those two things about it. God's reserved them, and they've refused to now bow a knee to Baal. The Calvinists believe that God's reserving of them is what caused them to refuse to bow a knee to Baal. On my view, what I believe is that they, because they believed in God, refused to bow a knee to Baal, and that is the reason God reserves them as his remnant. In other words, the reason that God reserves a remnant for himself is because, like Noah in Genesis 6, he believed. He followed God. Now, does that mean they're perfect? Does that mean they don't have sin? Does that mean they're fallen? Does that mean they don't need atonement? No. All of the things we say about the sinner and the fallen sinner and all those things are true of the 7,000 who refused to bow a knee to Baal. I'm sure they had a lot of horrible sins in their lives. If you looked at each individual 7,000 people in that story, all of them had sin, horrible sin, and they needed atonement. But what did they have? They had faith. And they refused to bow a knee to the false gods because they believed in God, and God reserved them as a remnant to accomplish his purpose through a small ragtag group of no names versus the leaders of the synagogues and all the places. And what is Paul trying to prove? Paul's saying God has always accomplished his purpose through a small ragtag group of remnant people who refuse to bow a knee to the false religions and who follow God. God always accomplishes purpose through a remnant. The remnant are those who believe versus those unconditionally picked before the foundation of the world for reasons unknown to us. That's the difference between the two worldviews, to hear those two out.
We're really lucky. But there's 7,000 who autonomously remained just and righteous. That's not what he says. I reserved myself 7,000 who've not bowed the knee to Baal. And so the Father, the idea of the Father being in possession of a people, very clearly understandable. There was no emphasis upon human autonomy and individuality at this time in Jewish understanding, Second Temple Judaism, et cetera, et cetera. So the idea that, when it says the Father has given them to me, what that means is that they had proven themselves to be, choice meats. I'll just keep using Leighton's own terminology. For those of you who aren't, go back, I'm sure we put into the title of that one, choice meats, didn't we? It's in the title somewhere. When was that? Give me a date on that. I sometime last year, Leighton put out a video where Leighton comes up with these analogies, okay? You know, bank robbers and all this stuff. And he doesn't do exegesis, he does analogesis, okay? He tells stories.
Okay, this is the false dilemma. Either Leighton does analogies or he does exegesis. It can't be that Leighton does exegesis and uses analogies in places like Unbelievable or this podcast, which are mostly laymen that you're trying to explain your exegetical findings to. It can't be that, because we have to straw man him. We can't steel man him. We have to straw man him. So we say Leighton doesn't do any exegesis. Matter of fact, all those provisionists, none of them do any exegesis. They're just telling stories. They're just using analogies. Instead of looking at the point of the analogy and the exegesis behind it, or going to the website, like he said earlier, to look at the details of my particular exegesis of any particular passage, he just simply grabs a podcast, plays a snippet, and then brings conclusion. Again, that's not the way you do good back and forth and disagreement with those you would call a brother in Christ. So don't follow James' lead on this. This is really, really poor apologetic methodology.
And creates narratives that you then try to fit the Bible into the narrative to make it sort of smooth stuff out where it doesn't really fit. And he's the one that used the language of choice meats. You choose choice meats, they're better meats. And that's who chooses to follow Christ, are the choice meats, the better meats. Sort of hard to avoid what that means, but I didn't make up the illustration, he did.
Actually, I didn't make up the illustration. Jeremiah did, in Jeremiah 24. He calls them choice figs, not choice meats. And the point of the analogy was to say that those who choose to follow Christ are choice in him. He's the choice meat, if you will. We are all undeserving. So even those who choose Christ, even those who choose to follow him, are undeserving. Their good works are even as filthy rags in the sight of God, apart from the atoning work of Christ, which is the response video I did to the whole choice meat debacle that he refers to, which, again, he doesn't listen to replies, and therefore he continues to repeat the same mistakes over again. So instead of understanding my comments about choice meat, God, Christ being the choice one, and therefore those who enter into him through faith, it's not meriting their salvation by doing so, by the way, which John Piper even has an article from back in the 70s explaining why it's not meritorious to believe in Christ. And I would highly recommend that at Soteriology 101, if you want to look for that, look for John Piper and meritorious, and you'll find it if you want more information on that. So please understand this. Where does this analogy come from? It comes from the scriptures. The Bible speaks of these things. And so you can blame that on the provisionist and ignore the scriptures, or you can actually go to the scriptures that we're referencing and say, here's what Jeremiah 24 is talking about when it talks about the choice figs and what he does with the choice figs versus the rotten ones. And you can deal with Jeremiah on that. You can call him a provisionist if you want, even, and straw man him even if you want to, but you got to deal with the actual text of the scriptures. Okay, so it's at the hour mark here that he finally starts to play my interview. And again, he took a little while to get there, and that's fine. It's his program. He could take as long as he wants to get anywhere he wants to, just like I can. He's just the one who always complains about the length of my versus the length of his.
Is said.
Let's start with the sheep first. If you hear the word sheep and you think, oh, those are people who were chosen before the foundation of the world for reasons that we just don't know. God, in a secret council, picks certain people, and those are his sheep. If what you think sheep means.
Now, just notice, when Jesus said this to the Jews, was that the first thing they were thinking about? They understand what sheep are.
Followers.
They see sheep all the
followers.
Time. Followers. The cities, even in those days, were relatively small. They all left the city at some point, and they were immediately in the rural countryside, and they saw flocks everywhere. They knew all about sheep.
They were followers.
And so they know that shepherds choose sheep. Sheep do not choose shepherds.
They choose them before they're ever born unconditionally? Because if you're going to take the analogy that far, it has to mean what exactly, it has to be precise. It means that the shepherds chose sheep before they were ever born. And they were born in an intimate relationship with the shepherd to where they automatically just recognize his voice immediately without listening and learning from it. They just automatically. No, they're not born that way because we already established Calvinists don't believe that. So like the butterfly in the cocoon, at some point in the sheep's life, he just starts listening and learning to his shepherd. It starts listening to the shepherd's voice. Is that what happens? No. What's the natural reading? Sheep are followers. They listen and learn from the father. A son comes along who's speaking the exact same thing as the father, and they recognize that voice because it's one voice, and they start following it. And the reason he would say as a rebuke, the reason you don't listen, the reason you don't learn from me, the Son, is because you have not listened and learned from the Father. The reason you don't follow me is because you are not a follower of the Father. You're not a sheep. Isn't that, guys, I mean, be objective. Georgie, who hopefully is listening to this, am I being unreasonable here? Is that not an unreasonable interpretation of this text versus what I think you're going to hear from him dismissing? Is that ultimately he's saying, if Calvinism's true, you don't believe because I don't want you, because that's what elect is on Calvinism, is that the elect are the ones I want, the non-elect are the ones I don't want, and that is a decision in eternity past. How else do you conclude that? And let yet hear what he says.
It's just a given. You can't get around it. And notice what he's doing is trying to say, do you really think they're talking about these grand eternal things and stuff like that? Well, given that he's going to be explaining the unbelief, he's saying you are not believing. He's explaining, just as in John 6, here.
What is it they're not believing, James? They're not believing in the Son. Okay. it's not just not believing, period, because that's you just have it one thing. It's like they're not believing in God the Father and the Son and salvation process. That's what you're thinking of it. No, they're not believing in Jesus as their Messiah. Why? Because they have not listened and learned from the Father. They have not followed the Father. That's what I'm saying. And again, it's fine if you disagree with that interpretation, but at least represent that interpretation.
In John 10, explain their unbelief.
Then it sounds like Jesus is saying, hey, you don't believe because you're not elect. You're not chosen. I don't really want you. In other words,
notice, you don't believe because you are not of my sheep. Notice he said, then adds, I don't really want you. That is an attempt to throw in an emotional thing.
Okay, but is it true? You can call it emotional if you want to, and it would be emotional to think that there's some people who are not elect of their Father before they're ever born. That is emotional, but is the fact that it's emotional make it untrue? Facts don't care about feelings, as we hear in the political world, and I agree with that statement. Facts don't care about your feelings. And so even though you think it's emotional to say that some people aren't wanted by Jesus, that is emotional, yes. But you can't therefore say, therefore it must be wrong, and therefore Leighton must be completely off base. No, it's a true statement. The fact that it's emotional is just a side issue. It doesn't make any difference. It's true. And so instead of distancing yourself from a truth, why not just own the truth and say, yes, that's why it is difficult. It is hard, but it is true. That's what Jesus is saying here, is that the reason these people are not believing is because Jesus doesn't want them. He rejected them. He's not dying for them. They're not his. They're not the one he's chosen. Why wouldn't you just say that that's what you believe? Why are you trying to distance yourself from that because it's emotional? Is that the reason?
Leighton understands his audience. And so he knows that in our day, to throw in that emotional thing, I don't want you, especially with when your congregation or your listenership made up mainly of people who have been taught to emote rather than to think, which is the younger.
Okay. People. Now he's talking to you guys. Okay. So the 165 are listening now, and the 5,000 or so that will listen to the YouTube page, and then another 5,000 or 6,000 will listen to the audio. He's talking about you now. Okay. So you guys don't think, you just emote. I'll let you handle that. His Twitter broadcast is Dr. Oakley 1689. He does read Twitter. Go let him have it. Y'all go tell him what you want to tell him. Are you thinkers? Or are you not? You go tell him what you think about that, because he's slamming on you now.
Generation today. Then that creates an automatic prejudice, rather than just quote what Jesus himself said. You do not believe because you're not of my sheep.
Right. And if you interpret sheep to mean unconditionally chosen before the foundation of the world, what is the answer to that then? Those unconditionally elected before the foundation of the world, those I don't want, those I'm not dying for, right? So that's just truth. Maybe emotional, may not like it because of its emotion, but it doesn't change the fact. But remember, that's not the way James White earlier interpreted the word sheep. The word sheep meant those in intimate personal relationship with the Father, those who have an intimate relationship and connection with him. And so how do you deal with that? Because that's our interpretation, not yours. Again, I'm not sure he in this broadcast, he doesn't catch it. I'm assuming he's going to catch it, and he's going to realize his error down the road somewhere. I would think he would have to.
I didn't really die for you. I'm not going to really die for you. Jesus is kind of in the back of Jesus's mind is the reason you're not coming is you're not really wanted. I don't really love you in a saving way. And that's what is in the mind of Jesus from the Calvinistic perspective. And I don't think that aligns at all with what we see throughout the text.
So notice he's brought in 4 or 5 extraneous issues from outside to try.
How is that extraneous? How is it extraneous to point out that what is in Jesus's mind when he says the reason you don't believe is that you are not a sheep means you don't believe because I haven't shown, and I'm not going to die for you. I'm not here for you. I'm here for some other sheep. I'm here for some other people, not you. I don't really want you. How is that extraneous to the meaning? We're trying to understand what is the meaning of Jesus in this text. Does he mean that? Is that what he's trying to communicate to people or not? How is that extraneous, James White?
Try to poison the mind, especially of a person who has imbibed a imbalanced concept of omnibenevolence to where there is only one attribute of God, and that's love. And so God cannot have any differentiation in love. All that Old Testament stuff about Israel over against Egypt or Babylon, don't worry about that. And so you're introducing this prejudice. You have to, because the definition he's going to give of sheep here is going to be so a-contextual, so outside of the context of...
My definition is the same one you gave earlier, James White. Those who have an intimate relationship with God. That's it. You already said that. And so now you're about to critique me for holding to the same definition of sheep as you have. Or you had, inconsistently, mind you, but nevertheless.
Of the Gospel of John, that you have to lay some foundation for it. And so what you want to do is you want to make somebody recoil from the conclusions and the way you're...
Okay, if truth makes people recoil, then let them recoil. I mean, surely you're not too worried about people recoiling from truth, Calvinist, right? I mean, James White, you're not concerned with people recoiling from truth, are you? So then why would you try to hide truth in order to avoid the recoiling of it? I'm simply speaking truth from the Calvinistic perspective. Nothing I've said is untrue about what Calvinists believe is in the mind of Jesus when he's saying this, if that interpretation is correct. I'm just simply laying it out there to help people to realize, is that really what Jesus would be saying, given all the other things we know about what Jesus said?
Stating it. Well, okay, I don't want that. And then once you provide something that's plausible, not contextual. Plausible and contextual are not the same thing. It's not derived from the text. It's plausible, but it's not contextual. Then someone goes, oh, okay, I'll grab that. So
what's not contextual about listening and learning from the Father, therefore believing the Son? It seems to be all through the context that we've already pointed out. So you'd have to demonstrate how it's not contextual.
You see how the methodology works? You're watching it. Well, I guess you're not watching it. I guess you're listening to it.
This is the same Jesus who weeps over Jerusalem, the same Jewish audience, who longs to get...
The same Jewish audience. No, it's not. It's not the same Jewish audience. In fact, in Matthew 23, read Matthew 23. That's the Jewish leaders. Probably the closest parallel you're going to get to the Jews here is the Jewish leadership that he pronounces judgment upon. And it's the ones that they have put themselves over that Jesus talks about desiring to gather. That's a whole different concept.
Okay, I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt. He may have thought I was quoting from Matthew 23:37. I wasn't. I was actually referring to Luke 19:41. And I'm going to put this in the broadcast, and please don't let me forget to put him back. He says, I tell you, if they become silent, the stones will cry out, which, by the way, I'm not sure why God would cause stones to cry out if people won't. It seems like he'd be effectually causing the people to cry out in the same way he would be effectually causing the stones to cry out. But nevertheless, verse 41, when he approached Jerusalem, he saw the city and wept over it, saying, if you had known this day, even you, the things which make for peace, but now they have been hidden from your eyes. This is what we talk about with judicial hardening, is that the Jews who have rejected the things of God, they've hardened themselves against the voice of God for so long. Now they're being given over to their spirit of stupor, to their stubborn rebellion. The truth of their own Messiah is being hidden from their eyes to make sure that the crucifixion takes place through them and the ingrafting of the Gentiles happens. All that makes sense. It's perfectly contextual. John 12 talks about it very clearly. In verse 39 and following, when he says, this is the reason you do not believe, because I've hardened your, given you a spirit of stupor, hardened your eyes, blind your eyes, hardened your ears so that you could not hear any longer. All those texts are about Israel being hardened in their rebellion because they refuse to listen and learn from the Father. And that's why they're in the condition they're in. So that's contextual, okay? So these things have been hidden from your eyes, for the day will come upon you when your enemies will throw up a barricade against you and so forth. So he's weeping over them. Okay, so the people he's weeping over, this is the context we get of people, Jesus, God saying, I've held up my hands to them all day long, longing to gather them. Okay, all of this vernacular is an expression of God's love for the same people who are now hardened and these things are hidden from their eyes, the hardened ones, the same ones Paul says, I would curse myself for their sake in Romans chapter 9, verses 1 through 3. This is a man speaking the very heart of God as under inspiration of God, saying, I would give up my salvation for the sake of these hardened Jews. That's the people whose these things are hidden from their eyes. And so we know that Jesus does not mean you cannot believe because I don't want you. You cannot believe because you're not unconditionally picked before the foundation of the world. No, it's more like what James White said earlier. You don't believe because you don't have an intimate relationship with the Father. Because if you had an intimate relationship with the Father, if you listen and learn from the Father, you'd believe his Son because they speak the same voice. Doesn't that make much more sense? I think that it does. And I did not forget to put him back in. All right, here we go.
For them, like a mother hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but they are unwilling. This is the same group of people that...
They are unwilling. The leaders are unwilling that the chicks be gathered. There's, you know, that.
Okay, so leaders can prevent chicks, people under them, from God's sovereign will. Again, even that interpretation, which is not what most commentators say that that's meaning, even that interpretation doesn't work with the quote unquote meticulous sovereign decree of God, because you've still got God being thwarted by rulers to bring people to himself that he wants. It's not avoiding the problem.
That distinction gets lost almost all the time.
God says that I've held up my hands.
Now notice, we're not staying in John 10, are we? We aren't even pretending to. And everybody who knows Leighton Flowers knows this is his MO. Just watch the...
But James White never goes to other texts in order to support a particular finding of his views. Go listen to his debate with a Unitarian who wants to try to keep him in the book of Acts to prove Unitarianism. And James White schools him on what proper hermeneutics and exegesis looks like in the whole counsel of using the whole counsel of God's word. I loved what James White says there, and I played it several times over, saying, I wonder if he ever listens to that for himself. Because when you do proper exegesis, proper hermeneutics is bringing in the whole counsel of God's word in order to understand controversial passages. Plus, again, he's playing one broadcast. He's not looking at the website and the other exegetical commentaries. He's pulling snippets out and critiquing that. When I started the program, by his own admission, he already acknowledged it, by saying you should go look at the exegesis and the other things provided for you at our website. He seemed to forget that, I guess.
Debate. We actually had a debate. It was supposed to be on a very limited number of verses. And his opening statement was all over the planet. And so was the prepared rebuttals and the prepared questions and the prepared closing, all over the place. The idea of focusing and let's derive our theology from this text. No, this is not what provisionism is by any stretch of the imagination. And the more it puts itself out there, the plainer that becomes to those who take time to actually...
There's a Romans 9 or the Debate Revisited broadcast that you should go back and listen to, because I actually go through my slides of the debate in my opener, because he's painted it as if, hey, Leighton just didn't even talk about Romans 9. And I actually put the slides of all the verses that I went through, and I counted the number of verses that I went through versus the number he went through. And I went through two verses more than he did. So you be the judge. Again, facts don't care about your feelings. The facts were laid out for you. If you want to go look at that video, please do.
Interact with it.
To this people all day long. That the same group of people that he says, I don't desire the perishing of anyone, but all to repent and to believe in Ezekiel 18. And so
just look up Ezekiel 18. Actually, you know what? I think it's on my personal page. I think it's on Dr. Oakley 1689. I did a couple studies on Wednesday nights.
You want us to go look at resources that you have on the side instead of just taking clips from you and not letting you speak for yourself? And what if we want to straw man you? What if we don't want to steel man you? What if we don't want to really understand what you believe about Ezekiel 18? What could we do then? Could we maybe just play small snippets from interviews and call you maybe somebody who, you know, analogizes and tells stories and, you know, does all the stuff but never does any exegetical? See, you could do the same thing both ways, but let's not do that. Let's not do that to James White. Let's treat him like we want to be treated, by looking at his resources. And so I encourage you to go look at his resources on his website on Ezekiel 18, understand what the Calvinist believes about Ezekiel 18, and then compare it to what we've said about it. I'd love for you to do that.
A number of years ago, we went through the Ezekiel 18 passages and stuff like that and dealt with the proverb that was being spoken of and how they're using it to avoid repentance and stuff like that. Check that out.
That thinking process doesn't align with other text. And so you have to ask yourself, what we've
done is we've jumped to a bunch of other texts, strung them together with rhetorical baling wire and said, well, it does sound like Jesus is teaching that he has his own sheep and he gives eternal life to his sheep and they'll never pray. That's what it sounds like, but that's not what the rest of the Bible teaches.
It's not what we were talking about. Back up and remember what we were talking about. We were talking about what is in the mind of Jesus. Is he saying, you don't believe because I don't want you. I didn't choose you. I'm not going to die for you, which is what, if you interpret the word sheep to mean elect, the reason you don't believe is because you're not unelect. You're not elected. You're not chosen. Okay. How does that align with what we know about Jesus laying down his life for his enemies? What do we know about Jesus based upon all these other texts? That's what we were talking about. We aren't even addressing the issue he's bringing up. And so maybe you just forgot. You get in the, you know, with me, with all the technology, you forget where you're going. But Maybe I'll give him the benefit of the doubt and just maybe he forgot the point that I was addressing.
And so here's going to be my suggestion, even though I didn't derive it from the text.
Could it mean if it doesn't mean what the Calvinists think it means? Well, the word sheep doesn't connote or even imply this concept of unconditional election before the foundation of the world. That's just imposed onto the text.
Of course, the use of the term sheep wasn't meant to do that because we're not talking about real sheep. But it is meant to be an analogy and it's meant to have some meaning to it. And the idea that the shepherd chooses a sheep does remain very much a part of the text. Yeah. It's
okay. But he doesn't choose them unconditionally before they're ever born. So what's your point? I mean, sheep listen and learn from their shepherd because they hear the voice enough that they recognize it. And then therefore they follow it. In the same way, those who listen and learn from the Father would recognize his voice when it's spoken through the Son. Again, my illustration works very well within that context. And I'm not sure what you're disagreeing with there.
Still there.
And once you put those lenses on and you think of sheep meaning that, it's really hard not to see it that way. And what you have to do is back away, be objective, take off those lenses and say, okay, what does he mean by sheep here? What does the word sheep mean idiomatically in that culture? Well, that's not a hard one because it means the same thing in our culture. I actually heard my teenagers calling one of their friends at school a sheep. And what they were talking about, obviously, was he's a...
Now, should anybody disagree with this? Should anybody disagree that sheep is analogous to follower? Obviously, I think sheep is analogous to follower. Who doesn't believe that? Even Calvinists I've heard admit, yes, sheep is analogous to a follower. That's what the analogy is illustrating. Why would a sheep follow the shepherd? Because he knows the voice of the shepherd. It's a follower, follows the shepherd. Why he disagrees with this, I'm not real sure. Maybe he's gotten so used to kind of a pattern of disagreeing with me that he just needs to disagree with me again.
Blind follower. He just does what everybody else does in that group.
Is that what anyone in Jesus's audience would have understood as a sheep? Of course not.
Why? James, this is why I want to have a discussion with you. Why in the world would you not think that Jesus is in that context, people in the agricultural world who know sheep would not have thought of sheep as being followers who follow their shepherd? That's the whole point. Look, I can't help it. I can't help it. I gotta go. Let's go to the text. Okay. Let's go to it. I'm trying to do this faster. And so I haven't been pulling up every verse here. But I just can't. I can't help it. We got to go through it. Okay, let's look at. Truly, I say to you, he who does not enter by the door into the fold of sheep, but climbs up some other way, he's a thief and a robber. In other words, other people who are claiming to be the Messiah, other people who are claiming to be of God, they're not. I am. Jesus is saying, I am. Okay, but he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him, the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice. And he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. Okay. He's leading them out. So they're following. So it's a follower here. Okay. When he puts forth all his own, he goes ahead of them and the sheep follow him. Okay. Sheep are followers. It's what they do. That's what they're known for. Why would you disagree with that? Why would you disagree that sheep are followers? Goes ahead of them. They follow them because why do they follow him? Because they were irresistibly and effectually chosen before the foundation of the world and given a new nature so that they will listen and learn from him and follow his voice. No, because they know his voice, period. That's all it says. So the reason you would know the voice is because you have an intimate relationship with the Father. Therefore, you would hear his Son and you would listen and learn from the Son. You would want to know more because you're a follower of the Father. So they know his voice. A stranger, they simply will not follow. They will flee from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. So look at the word follow over and over and over again to this text. Why in the world would even a Calvinist try to disagree that the word sheep is analogous to follower? Unless you're just trying to be disagreeable. I don't know.
Jesus was not talking to modern teenagers. And in fact, Jesus had made it so plain. He's talking about the exact behavior of sheep and shepherds and enclosures and the calling out of the sheep. I mean, he was focusing people on what they would have known in their day, which would not have been blind follower at all. In fact, Jesus's emphasis is upon I know them and they know my voice.
Okay. And who does he know? Who knows him and who does he know? Anyone who loves God is known by him. So there's a connection to the intimate personal relationship, but is that arbitrarily? Is that you're born with that already? You're born already knowing him with intimate relationship? Or have you listened and learned from him and grown into that relationship where you've learned to recognize his voice? Again, I don't see the problem. And some were talking about, well, they follow because he owns them. Well, are they born owned by him? I thought you were born under the wrath of God, a child of the devil. Are you born owned by him already? And what does that mean? Because according to 2 Timothy there, the Lord knows those who are his. So he knows those who he owns. And who are the ones he knows? Anyone who loves God. If anyone loves God, it's known by the Father. So this owning and knowing is connected with intimate relationship, as he's already defined sheep as meaning, intimate relationship, which you just can't assume is just something arbitrarily given to some people and not others before they're ever born. It's just, that's nowhere in the text. That's being read eisegetically into the text by a Calvinistic hermeneutic. All right, here we go.
Is that blind follower? This is, again, for those that are not have not had to deal with the analogesis of Leighton Flowers for as many years as we have, then you just haven't heard this. But no matter what the text is, he's going to say, well, it's like, that's when you know you're not going to get any exegesis of this.
It's just, I think how many times Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is like, over and over and over and over. Jesus uses stories and parables to explain heavenly things in earthly ways.
The text from him. He thinks this is exegesis. He really does believe that telling stories is exegesis. That has sadly been demonstrated over and over and over. Well, it's like this. Just go. You don't even have to listen to our interactions. Go listen to when he's on Unbelievable and stuff like that. It's the same thing all the way along.
Okay. So again, his examples are quick, short interviews that happened in a short span of time, not let's go to Leighton's material. Let's look at this actual published material, or let's look at this commentator that he recommends here, or let's go through this exegetical commentary of this author that he recommends on his, none of that. No, that would be steel manning. It's easier if I just take snippets of things that I want to confront and just play those things. And again, that's just not the way to do good apologetics, especially when you're doing intramural kind of discussions like this between Christians. He should at least be as gracious with me as he is with his Muslim friends. And he's very gracious with his Muslim friends. If you have not heard him, he goes the extra mile to try to represent them correctly and to play their stuff and to be cordial to them. If he showed a 10% of the amount of grace to me as he does to the Muslims, I would be happy with that.
And that's what a sheep does. Sheep were known to be followers. And so what Jesus is saying is, you don't believe in me, the Son, because you're not a follower of my Father.
And where'd that come from? Did anyone catch where that came from? Because I didn't catch where that came from. This is what you do is you.
It came from the text all throughout John 10. All throughout the book of John, for that matter, he's talking about the equality of, if you listen to Abraham, you would believe in me. If you listen to the Father, if you listen to learn, you would come to me. So what we saw in John 6:45, if those who listen to learn from the Father, they will come to the Son. This is throughout all the texts. That's where it comes from. I mean, this is not something you should disagree with, Dr. White.
Demonstrate knowledge of some background things. You throw some verses out there. You get people going, oh, this guy knows more about the Bible than I do. And then you, boom, throw that one in there. And whoa, wait a minute. Where'd that come from? It didn't come from anywhere. It's ungrounded assertion. Just, I can't get it from the text. So
he believes that sheep means unconditionally elected people before the foundation of the world. Something never mentioned in any text in John or anywhere for that matter. You might be able to bring it out of Ephesians 1 if you worked really hard at it. and a portion of John, Romans chapter 9, but certainly you can't get it from the book of John. You certainly don't get it from John chapter 10. And yet he's accusing me of ungrounded presumptions because I am saying that the Father and the Son are one, and therefore those who listen and learn from the Father will believe the Son. And that's stated over and over and over again, not only in the text in question, but in all throughout the book of John that we've already pointed out. Again, you be the judge.
Oh, I'm going to bring it in real quick. It's a sleight of hand trick. It's how people do card stuff, but it's being done theologically because it's not a part of the text.
Okay, sleight of hand assumes intentionality. Like Leighton is trying to deceive you by bringing in by tricking your eyes by sleight of hand. Okay, again, that's putting motive on to somebody, judging somebody based upon their motive. I don't think James White is trying to trick his listeners. I don't think he's trying to do a sleight of hand. I think he's trying to clearly exegete what the Bible says is true, and he's trying to make it clearly known. I would think he would say the same thing about Michael Brown. I think he would believe Michael Brown is not trying to do sleight of hand in his interpretation of John 6, which is the same as mine, by the way. I think he would know that his character is not bad because he interprets it differently. And so when you assume bad character because somebody interprets something differently than you do, that's poisoning the well, and that makes it difficult to have cordial conversations with people.
And over again throughout the book of John, you see Jesus saying, I am speaking the same words that my Father spoke. If you listen to my Father, then you would know me.
In other words, Jesus claims to have perfect unity with the Father in his teaching.
Yes.
That's true.
Good.
Jesus does make the claim that he is not a renegade deity coming up with a new teaching and drawing people away from the worship.
Yet earlier, you accused that of being, you believe in this two shepherd thing, and there's another shepherd coming in. Remember at the very beginning of this program? Remember that? Yet he's now acknowledging, he's agreeing with what I'm saying. Is that what the Father teaches? Exactly what the Son teaches. Therefore, if you believe what the Father teaches, then you would agree with what the Son teaches. It's really, really simple.
Ship of the one true God. That's true.
If you listen to Abraham, you would know who I am because Abraham spoke of me, he says in the book of John. In other words...
Well, he says in John chapter 8, Abraham rejoiced to see his day. And that Jesus brings up many witnesses. This is one of the themes in John is the witnesses to who I am. No question about it.
If you recognize the Father's voice because you listen and learn from him, then you would recognize the Son's voice because the Son's voice is saying the exact same thing.
That sounds extremely plausible, but he's strung together about three or four different contexts that are actually not related to one another.
Okay, so at least he acknowledges this is the first semi-nice thing he said. second semi-nice thing. The first one was we used to, in the Radio Free Geneva's, deal with the bad non-Calvinists. Now we start dealing with the better ones. I would say that's kind of maybe a backhanded, nice compliment. This is the second nice thing that James White says about us. And so he's saying at least it's plausible. So at least he's acknowledging, hey, this is a plausible thing. Okay. But then he says, but he's bringing in all these backhanded things. Now, if you could get in a debate, I would say, okay, stop. What are the backhanded things? Let's take out about evil motive out. Let's not say it's backhanded or that I'm trying to card trick you here or anything like that, sleight of hand. What things am I bringing in that you don't agree with? Is it that the Father and Son are one? Now you've already agreed with that. Is it that sheep is referring to those who already have an intimate relationship of learning and listening to the Father so that they would believe the Son? No, you've already agreed that that's what sheep means, is that one has an intimate relationship. You've already agreed with that. So what is it exactly, James, that I have snuck in the back door here that you don't agree with, that you think is wrong? This is why debate and having discussion is so important. That's why I'd love to have a discussion with James White, because I could just stop him and say, James White, what do you mean by that? What have I snuck in here? What have I said that you don't agree with? Because you've already conceded the two major points that I need to be able to interpret this as plausible.
It sounds like some of what he just said was from John 6:45. The problem is John 6:45 is describing the drawing that the Father does of those that he gives to the Son. And that's why they come to the Son infallibly. All that the Father gives the Son, come to the Son. All that are drawn by the Father to the Son, come to the Son. That is a powerful act of God. In John 6:45, he explains how that works.
For the sake of time, because we're at the 150 mark already, go to our John 6 commentaries where Brian Wagner and I go through it. There's also some short ones that go through John chapter 6 if you want to hear our perspective on that. I'm just not going to be able to take the time for it.
There is a teaching. There is a effective act of the Father. But notice what Leighton is doing. Leighton turns that into the capacity and ability of the individual. If you were just listening to the Father, well, the problem is in John 6:45, that teaching is given to a specific people. It's given to the elect that are given by the Father to the Son. So it's not just some general provisional, I'm going to throw this out here, it's up to you thing. That's his thing that he's now trying to sneak into a text that nowhere contains any of this stuff.
And so what Jesus is saying is, you won't believe in me, the Son, because you're not a follower of the Father. If you were a follower of the Father, then you would recognize my voice and you would believe in me.
Now, that sounds great. Well, where is that in John 10 again? Make sure, ask the question.
Okay, it sounds great. Does that mean you agree with it? Or you just like the sound of it? Or I'm not sure. I'm assuming he would have to disagree with it. It sounds great, but where is it in John chapter 10? You've already conceded that it's in John chapter 10 by saying that the sheep mean those who have an intimate relationship with God. And that God is, Jesus doesn't have in his mind this concept or idea that he's rejecting people because that's somehow poisoning the well. Again, you haven't shown me anything that I've brought in that you're disagreeing with. Are you talking about the verses that I talked about where Jesus expresses his love for Israel, where he weeps over Israel? Is that what you're saying that I'm bringing in the back door of the text is about God's intention and love for these people who are supposedly not his sheep and never could become his sheep because of some ontological condition they were born into and they have no control over that?
Where does this fit into what Jesus says in John chapter 10? He says that the ones saved by him, the Father, are the same ones. But nowhere is there anything about this new definition of sheep. Nowhere is there anything that, well, the sheep are the ones that choose to listen to the Father.
Okay. You've already defined what sheep are in a way that I agree with. Sheep are those who follow and have an intimate relationship with their shepherd. Okay? We've already agreed with that. We all agree with that. They're followers who have an intimate relationship with their shepherd, and they recognize their shepherd's voice. You believe that happens to individual sheep who are given some kind of magical water that they drink and cause them to automatically start listening and learning from their shepherd. I'm not trying to misrepresent you, but if I'm sticking into that analogy, it's the only thing I could think of is something supernatural causes them to change their nature at some point in time where all of a sudden they wake up one day and they listen and learn from their shepherd who apparently chose them before they were even born. Okay. Versus my understanding, which is that the sheep listen and learn from the voice of the elder shepherd, and they listen and learn to that voice, and then the son has a voice that sounds just like his daddy's voice because they have the same genetics. And the sheep, when they hear the son's voice and it sounds exactly like his daddy's voice, they go, that's my shepherd. And they follow that voice because they recognize the voice because they sound the same. They speak the same thing. Do you see the difference of the two analogies? Which one makes more sense to you? Which one's more reasonable? Which one doesn't have Jesus rejecting most of humanity before they're ever born for reasons unknown to us?
And so they were the faithful Israelites. They have the choice meats. The choice meat Jews. Clearly.
Or choice figs, if you'd rather use Jeremiah's voice. Either way.
Not pork. The choice meat Jews. I woke Rich up. It just looked like he needed. You know when the gaze starts going off? Way up there someplace. And you just have to throw a little thing in there and it hits him upside down. That's he's still hunting choice meats. How long ago was that? June 20th of last year. So almost exactly a year that we've had the choice meats thing. Okay. So you can go back to the program of June 20th where we played. This was. There's a what? Oh, a Beth Moore segment. Oh, that'll make everybody happy. Great. So Beth Moore and choice meats in the same program. Oh, it went from Beth Moore into a Radio Free Geneva. That's it. That was a choice program. Yeah. So, yes. So Leighton's analogesis does get him into deep trouble. And the choice meats one was deep, but only because it was so clear in what it actually says about what he's saying. and really turns the light on so you can see this is what really.
And yet you misconstrue what I was saying, even after I gave you clear indication of what my intention was, and you refused to deal with that. So you're not interested in actually portraying to your audience what I believe and what I've said. Because if you were, then you would actually play what I've said in follow up to that. And you're not interested in that because it doesn't work for your Radio Free Geneva opener. Just like the no comment just doesn't work for your getting your audience all fired up against me and painting me in the worst possible light.
He's saying is that these people are the choice meats, and that's why God chooses them. And so this is why they're sheep. They're choice meats. So that would be choice lamb, I guess. Would that be the choice meat? Would be the choice it's lamb, and you're really good lamb, and it's because you've been listening to the Father, and that's how you get around this. Because
okay, so listening to the Father is meritorious if you're doing it freely. See the conclusion he made. So what the Calvinist is saying, if you listen and learn from God versus Muhammad or Confucius or an atheist down the street. If you listen and learn from Jesus and the Father, then that's meritorious and you've earned your salvation. You don't even need atonement. You just earned it. That's ultimately what he is saying of our view. And what we're saying, you can listen and learn from the Father. You can believe in the Father. You can believe in what he says and still be as a filthy rag in his sight, if not for the saving work of Christ on the cross, whose righteousness has to be put onto our account. We have to be clothed in his righteousness. Nothing about listening and learning the Father earns our salvation, people. Okay? That's the whole point. You have to listen and learn the Father to realize that. You have to listen and learn from the Father to realize that you have no merit in you and that you must rely upon the merit of Christ. But relying upon the merit of Christ isn't in and of itself meritorious for yourself and your own salvation. This is not a difficult concept, and I know James White's bright enough to get it. Is he willing to get it so as to represent it rightly? It doesn't sound like it.
Without that, it really would naturally read, just like John 6 and John 8, it would naturally read as, you know, like we went over John Lennox's Determined to Believe, and we walked through his attempts to get around John chapter 6. It's the same kind of process going on here, just not nearly as, just with a lot more stories. Because I think obviously John Lennox deals with all sorts of other issues. Leighton Flowers does not deal with all sorts of other issues. This is
actually, I deal with a lot of other issues involving evangelism and practical evangelism, one-on-one evangelism. I deal with other apologetic issues. I don't do a podcast on them, and you don't deal with any of those other issues. You're just not aware of those other issues. That's where I work here, Texas Baptist. In fact, oftentimes James White will talk about me being imbalanced because I don't deal with other apologetic debates. Like I don't debate Mormons and Muslims and other things. And therefore, you're imbalanced. And that's to the man. That's a to the man kind of argument. I could say the same thing about James White. I could say, because you don't do practical training and personal one-on-one evangelism like I do in my job, you don't understand that the Calvinistic methodologies actually hurt personal evangelism strategies. And actually you have to avoid some of the claims of Calvinism in a personal evangelistic endeavor, therefore revealing that Calvinism is not a practical or tenable way to do evangelism. And if you were involved in more evangelistic strategies like I am for my job, you would be more balanced as an apologist. So I could do the same thing for you. Now, I'm not saying that about James White because I don't think that that's appropriate to use fallacious arguments to say because his career is different than my career, because Ken Wilson is a hand surgeon instead of an apologist who has a podcast that sits around and talks about these things day in and day out. Therefore, he doesn't deal with these issues the way that I deal with them or whatever it is. Some of us have different jobs than James White does. go figure. And therefore, we deal with different things and we have different things on our plate than what James White does. That's a given. But you shouldn't assume that because somebody doesn't do what I do every day, therefore they can't make a sound argument. They can't make a biblical argument. Those are to the man arguments, and they should be ignored as fallacies.
This is the one issue that Leighton Flowers deals with. So he has a lot more stories to tell than John Lennox would, because you have more time to develop lots and lots of stories.
Well, I tell more stories because they're analogies, and I worked with youth for a long time, and youth tend to relate to parables and analogies, and I like to follow the example of Jesus, who used a lot of stories.
But the natural reading of the text would not lead you to this, well, the sheep have made themselves sheep by listening to the Father, And therefore, now they're going to hear, that's why they hear the voice of this other shepherd. There's only one shepherd.
See, this baffles me. This is why I want to debate James White on this issue, or at least have a discussion with him, just to have a back and forth discussion. I'm talking about one shepherd, the triune nature of God, okay? The Father, the Son, okay? The Father speaks. If you listen and learn to the Father, then when the Son comes down from heaven here to earth, when he comes down from heaven and he speaks, he's speaking the same things that the Father spoke throughout the prophets and throughout the Old Testament and throughout the scriptures. You would listen and learn from the Father. I'm talking about two shepherds, talking about one shepherd through the Father, and then now the Son being revealed. I don't understand how that's hard concept to get. I really don't.
Nowhere does it say that the Son took over the Father's flock that had chosen the Father of their own free will because their choice meet.
And so this is not
still man or straw man. I'll let you be the judge.
Thing about your inability to become a sheep. This is nothing about your inability.
Your inability to become a sheep.
Okay. This is why I titled the broadcast Becoming a Christ Follower, because the word follower means sheep. Okay. Becoming a follower of Christ, becoming a Christ follower, becoming a sheep. How does one become a sheep? They enter in through the gate, the shepherd's gate, to become a sheep. And anyone who believes in Christ through faith can enter that fold, can join the church, the body of Christ, the sheep pen, if you will. Okay. You can become a follower of Christ. You're not born a follower of Christ. You can become a follower of Christ. Just like you're not born a sheep, you can become a sheep. Just like you're not born in an intimate love relationship with the Father, you can become in an intimate love relationship with the Father by listening and learning from him, just like you would in any other relationship, by the way. The reason I have an intimate relationship with my wife is because I listen and learn from Laura, because I have conversations with Laura. I'm with Laura. That's how I have a relationship with her. Same way, how do you have a relationship with the Father? You listen and learn from the Father. You develop that relationship. You're not born with that or without it, okay? You establish that. And even the Calvinist doesn't believe you're already born a believer with intimate relationship. Therefore, my interpretation fits better than his, seemingly, but he hasn't dealt with that yet.
Because see, in the man-centered way of looking at things, whether you're a sheep or not, to you, it's your autonomous choice.
Well, it's not autonomous if you're responding to the Father's call. So if the Father is calling you into relationship, it's not autonomous if you're responding to him. Autonomous means you're doing something on your own. So sin is autonomous. In other words, when I sin, when I rebel against the things of God, what am I doing? I'm separating myself from the will of the Father. That's autonomous. When God calls me to repentance and faith and I respond to his call of repentance and faith to step inside of his provision, then there's nothing autonomous about that. That's me interacting with the call of the Father, the call of the shepherd, if you will, in this situation. So again, he's just not steel manning, he's straw manning me.
To choose, you either get to be one of Christ's sheep or not one of Christ's sheep. No one in that day would have understood it that way. That kind of Western individualism, just
again, his view is the Western individualism. My view is what was held to by the earliest church fathers is held to by all of Eastern Orthodoxy for the most part, as far as our understanding of these texts, at least. This is not Westernized individualized. He is Westernized and individualized it as the elect being individual people that have been chosen. This is Calvinism is Western individualized, not my interpretation. It's just, it's kind of funny that he uses that terminology when Western individualism is really very much a mark of Calvinism.
Would not even be a part of the interpretation. Wouldn't even be there. And so the whole idea of becoming sheep, Jesus had said in John chapter 8, why don't you hear my words? Because you don't belong to God. Why aren't you believing in me? John 6, because you're not chosen by God. John 10, you're not of a sheep.
And that's exactly what I said earlier when he said, oh, you're painting it as just, you know, it was poisoning the well. The reason you don't believe is because you're not chosen. He doesn't want you. He's not going to die for you. The same people he weeps over, the same people he holds out his hands to them all day long, the same people he hopes will be provoked to envy and leave their unbelief and be grafted back in, according to Romans chapter 11. All that we just have to push aside as, oh, that's just superfluous stuff. That doesn't have anything to do with John 10. We just can't look at that stuff. It's not related to this. That'll mess us up. That'll confuse our tulip. And we just can't have anything that confuses our tulip here.
But you can be, right? That's what Jesus said in John 6 and John 8 and John 10. But you can be, just do this. No, that's not actually what happened in any of those passages at all. It's just not there, but it has to be there.
He calls them to repentance after he's raised up. Remember, when Jesus is down from heaven here on earth, he's not trying to call all people to repentance and faith because he has a purpose to accomplish. He's hidden these things from them now. Okay. And so he doesn't call them to repentance through the gospel until he's raised up, and then he sends the gospel out through his messengers that he's chosen beforehand to be his messengers. And he has trained them in the way that they should go. So, again, you could contextualize these verses and try to make them support your perspective. But if you understand in context what Jesus is doing, you understand he's calling them a brood of vipers and telling them to eat my flesh and drink my blood and not give them much explanations and speaking to them in parables, lest they see, hear, understand, and turn so as to be healed, for the purpose of hiding the truth of his messiahship so that they ultimately crucify him. As the same reason that he even points out in this text about them trying to stone him for blasphemy, because he's obviously claiming to be divine. And so, I think that context is pretty clear.
Once you have revisionism and analogesis,
to come to recognize his voice, this is a rebuke of those who have grown hardened in their unbelief, because just like Hebrews warns against, when you hear the voice of God, do not harden your hearts. These people's hearts had become hardened, and they had not been listening and learning from the Father.
Okay, so he grabs hold of a text in Hebrews that is addressed by the writer of the Hebrews to the Christian congregation as a warning to the congregation, and somehow, you know, doesn't even blush to try to drag that into this particular context. So you got a warning to Christians in the church who are facing people who are apostatizing, and we're just going to go right over here, and let's not worry about the completely different context. And now we've got the Jewish people are the Christian church, which couldn't be in danger of apostasy. But anyways, now the Jewish people are the Christian church, and so we can apply those warnings here about the hardening of the hearts. This is what analogesis gets you.
Okay, so if you don't like Hebrews, if the warning in Hebrews is not good for you and you need from John, let's go to John chapter 12. Verse 38, and this was to fulfill the word of Isaiah the prophet, which he spoke, Lord, who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For this reason, they could not believe. So we're about to give, Jesus is about to give us an explanation as to the reason that his audience in John could not believe. Does he say it's because of the way they were born under Adam, because of a decree of God, because they weren't elect? Let's see. For Isaiah said again, he has blinded their eyes. He has hardened their hearts. Who is he? God. Okay. And who is he blinded? Who is there? Israel. All right. People who have rejected him, refused to listen and learn for him. Now he's giving them over to their rebellion. He's hardened their hearts so that they would not see with their eyes, perceive with their hearts, and be converted and not heal them. This is the same passage that that Paul refers to in Acts chapter 28. We won't go there right now, but y'all are familiar with Acts 28. We've gone through it 1,000 times, where he says the Jews have become hardened. They're ever seeing, never perceiving, ever hearing, never understanding, because they have closed their eyes. It says otherwise they might see, hear, understand, and turn. Therefore, I take the message to the Gentiles and they will listen. He contrasts the Jews who won't listen because they've closed their eyes and become hardened with the Gentiles who will listen, proving that it's not an ontological reality from birth of every single individual because of the fall of Adam, but they're in this hardened state of unbelief. They're in this hardened state of unbelief because they've rejected their Messiah for so long, and now it's being hidden from their eyes so as to bring about the redemption for the world, for all the families of the world. So you have to keep all those things in mind in order to understand the biblical context.
They had grown hardened to his voice, and therefore they're not recognizing the voice when it comes from the Son, their shepherd.
Their shepherd. So in a text where Jesus says, you are not my sheep, he says, well, if they're the Jewish people, they are his sheep. Maybe it's just a potential.
I was just talking about their own. Like he came to his own and they've refused him at First John. That's all I was meaning it as. Is he came to his own first and they have refused their own Messiah, the one that they should be listening to, because they've rejected the Father for so long. They've grown hardened to his voice. Now they can't listen and learn from the Father. Again, he's not trying to steel man me, so he's not trying to understand what I'm really saying. He would rather grab on that word there. Oh, these people are not even sheep, and he's going to call them the shepherd anyway, instead of understanding my intention.
Still shepherd then? I don't know. It's really hard to figure. Once you have your conclusion that you have to have, but it doesn't come from the text, the damage done to the text becomes extensive.
Oh, the irony.
It really does.
That's the context that John chapter 10 is speaking in. He even goes on to say in that context, if you don't believe my words, at least believe the signs and wonders. He's pleading with them. This is not an idea or a concept that Jesus doesn't really want them to believe or doesn't really love them.
Do you know what that comes from? You know which part of John 10 that comes from? That was after they picked up stones to stone him. Yeah. So Jesus is giving the defense against their allegation of blasphemy. That's where he goes to, remember, he goes to Psalm 82. He accused them of being unrighteous judges. I said, you're gods. You should fall.
Why is that? Of course, it's what's happened in the context. I don't disagree with any of that. But how does that address the point I was making, Dr. White? It has nothing to do with the point I was making. I'm not sure. This is why I want to have a discussion, so I can stop you and go, what's going through your mind right now that you think you're somehow rebuking my position by referring to the context that we all agree with and can clearly see? Of course, they're trying to stone him. That's the whole point. I was saying he's hiding the truth of his messiahship from their eyes so that they do want to kill him for blasphemy. He's getting to the cross. That's his mission. Remember?
Fall like men. And he is actually rebutting their accusation of blasphemy. And that becomes Jesus pleading with them to believe in him. I didn't make up choice meats. I'm not making this up. Leighton Flowers does not do exegesis. He just doesn't. And if you want the proof of this, I don't know how many hours on his YouTube page. I know that my name is associated with minimally 40%, either in title or content. Minimally, maybe more.
For the last 2 years, 3 months, I have never initiated a conversation with James White. I've only replied to dividing line programs that he has brought provisionism up and me specifically up. Ever since I did that video where I said I love James White, and I kind of gave him a reprieve to say, you know, we don't have to go back and forth. I understand why he's rough around the edges. He does apologetics for a living. You get rough around the edges when you battle as a warrior. And I made that comment. From that point on, I've not done a video or done a broadcast confronting James White unless he has brought us up first and I come on to defend. That's it. Okay. And a lot of my broadcasts are with John Piper, is probably even maybe a little bit more than James White. If John Piper ever did broadcast about me on a regular basis, John Piper would have a lot more, because I tend to answer people when they do the broadcast, because I actually listen to people's response videos, unlike Dr. White. And so I like to learn from my opponents. I like to listen to them. I like to glean information from them and respond back and forth with them. And James White doesn't do that.
Of hours and hours and hours and hours and hours. I simply say to you, if you know what exegesis is, you will be able to see the difference between exegesis and allegoregesis.
Reading the text and saying what you think about it is not exegesis. James White thinks that. Okay. Jonathan Pritchett called him out on that from one of the very beginning broadcasts. Just because you read the text and then maybe quote a few of the words in Greek doesn't mean you're doing exegesis any more so than anything that I've done, okay? Exegetical commentaries, we've talked about before, when you pick up the commentaries, the hermeneutic starts with the historical context of who's the author, who is he speaking about, what's going on in the context, understanding who the author is, understanding who the audience is. That's why when you pick up a commentary like this, you'll have pages and pages of the setting, the authorship, the location of the author, all of that information. All of that's done to do exegesis. What James White has reduced exegesis to is line by line, verse by verse, reading the verse, commenting on a couple of the Greek declensions or something like that, and then telling people what I think about it. And he thinks he's doing exegesis on his program. That's not full exegetical work. We're commenting about our points of contention, and that's based upon exegetical work, which takes a lot of time to do, and it's not usually done on the cuff, especially in a live broadcast.
if you will but take the time. I would not suggest it personally. I mean, there's only so much time in the world. And I'm going to be doing an hour and a half to almost 2 hours today. The response will probably be 4 hours long. It may be being aired even right now, for all I know. But yeah, I wouldn't suggest it. But if you want to, it's there.
He is accomplishing his purpose through even their unbelief. And that has to be understood within the context of the New Testament as well, is that when Jesus is down from heaven, he's not trying to get everyone to come to faith in him right up front.
It's just very, again, rather idiosyncratic.
Okay, I was pulling up the John 10 passage because he seemed to be mocking the idea that Jesus was asking them to believe in the works. But that's exactly what the passage says. So let me just push it in here. Verse 38, if you do not do the works of my Father, if I do not do the works of my Father, then don't believe me. But if I do them, though you don't believe me, believe the works so that you may know and understand that the Father is in me. Doesn't that sound like a plead to, if you don't believe that I am who I say I am, at least believe the works, the miraculous works that I've done, the signs to demonstrate these things. That sounds like what he's saying there. I'm not sure what he was disagreeing about that, but I had to pull that in to make sure that y'all saw it. So, all right, we'll continue on.
Jesus is down from heaven. Most of us refer to that as the incarnate state. During the period of Jesus's humiliation, his incarnation, not down from heaven. Let's say I've got a friend right now. It's down in Branson. just going down and visiting. Just don't know where this terminology obviously always comes from.
This is a scholar who's done a ton of exegesis on John chapter 6, right? I mean, he knows John 6 backwards and forwards, right? I mean, he's done exegesis on John 6, right? Maybe I misunderstood him. I listened to this fast speed when I was walking, and I don't remember this little section. It was probably interrupted by a dog. There was a dog at a point that I was kind of navigating, I think, around this time. Let me back up. Maybe I misunderstood what he said there. I want to give him the benefit of the doubt here.
Incarnation, not right. Down from heaven. It's like I've got a friend right now. It's down in Branson. just going down and visiting. Just don't know where this terminology obviously always comes from.
He's going to be embarrassed by this one. Sorry. Just like I think he's going to be embarrassed by saying that sheep means having an intimate relationship with the Father. I think he's going to be embarrassed by this one. Okay, so let's go to John chapter 6, this is the same thing that happened in the debate when maybe it's a different translation. No, it's NASB. He likes the NASB because in the debate, he really got onto me about the noble cause thing. And that was the NIV translation, and he just wasn't familiar with it. And so I kind of called him out and said, well, it's right there in the passage. And it was the NIV, which is not the most popular translation, I understand. But I grew up on the NIV just because that's what my church used. And so that's what I learned a lot of my verses in and what I used. It's not my favorite study translation, by the way. I like the NASB is one of my favorite, is what I use in my book. But okay. All right. I'm just going to back it up one more time. That way, if somebody like Kevin or somebody that likes to listen to these things and then snippet things, let's just go back again and let's play this through and make sure we really understand what he's saying.
Again, rather idiosyncratic. When Jesus is down from heaven, most of us refer to that as the incarnate state. During the period of Jesus's humiliation, incarnation, not down from heaven. It's like I've got a friend right now. It's down in Branson. just going down and visiting. Just don't know where this terminology obviously always comes from.
So where does the terminology come from? Okay, let's look. That's like, for the bread of God is that which comes down out of heaven and gives life to the world. Okay, so down from heaven. Down out of heaven. And then they say to him, Lord, always give us this bread. Jesus says to them, I am the bread of life. Comes to me, will not hunger. I think it's used again a couple of other times. Verse 38. For I have come where? down out of Branson. Nope, down from heaven. Okay. Maybe he's just forgotten some things. Maybe he's just forgot that's actually vernacular of the scripture, not of Leighton Flowers. But again, when you get on a roll of just disagreeing with somebody, just because you have to disagree with everything they say, because they're the evil provisionist down the road, you tend to do this kind of thing where you can't see anything that they say as possibly good or agreeable. I just can't agree with anything because he's Leighton. And if he's Leighton, he has to be wrong. He just has to be wrong about saying down from heaven. That's just horrible, even though it's in the actual context. So, all right.
But here the idea is that it's almost a dispensational idea that during the incarnation, Jesus isn't trying to get everybody saved. That's going to be for later. Well, yeah.
Okay, so he agrees with that. So we all concede then. There's a point of agreement. Okay, we can agree, James White. Jesus isn't trying to convince everybody that he is the Messiah while down from heaven. Okay? He's not trying to get everybody to come to him right now. He's not entrusting himself to them, as it says in John 2 is this. There's several passages. Clearly, he's hiding the truth from them using parabolic language, Mark 4, Matthew 13, other passages like that. 1 Corinthians, as we've already mentioned, chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. These things were hidden from them. Otherwise, they never would have crucified the Lord of glory, it says. That's Paul's words, not mine, not the provisionist Leighton. That's Paul, okay? So we've already agreed, you've even conceded, yes, it's true. He's not trying to get them all saved right now, but he has a plan, he has a purpose, he has a strategy that he's getting to the cross. And that's going to be ultimately through the Jews of the day thinking he's a blasphemer. That's how they're going to crucify him. So he keeps them in the dark using parabolic language. I think we even played a John Piper episode where he was having this conversation. He actually talks about the messianic secret in this point. From our perspective, he actually delineates it just like I just now did, almost verbatim. And it was good to hear a Calvinist actually support and understand this idea of God's strategy in human history, which is the name of a book, by the way, where all this is laid out as well, by Forrester Marston, if you're interested in that.
In the sense that you have to have the message of the cross and the resurrection before you can start proclaiming the message of the cross and the resurrection.
Yes, you have to be raised up before you draw all men to yourself. You're exactly right. He's getting it. It seems like it's almost like clicking in his brain, right? Wow, what I'm saying, maybe. I don't know.
But then comes Leighton's, and this is where all the judicial hardening stuff comes from. Because that's a tough thing for provisionists to deal with, is all the judicial hardening stuff. And
judicial hardening is what convinced me to leave Calvinism, just so you know. Because what is there to judicially harden if everybody's already born blind, deaf, and dumb to truth? Truth. The judicial hardening is what convinced me that Calvinism is untrue. Why would you blind somebody who's corpse-like dead from the beginning? Why would you use parables to keep them from faith and repentance if they're born incapable of believing and repenting unless unconditionally elected and irresistibly graced? It doesn't make any sense. Judicial hardening is on our side, not theirs. Because what is God judicially hardening if not the free will of the rebellious creature? It makes no sense. It's the whole concept we talked about before when in the debate, even when James White talks about, well, God can restrain evil or he can permit evil. Okay, what is he restraining and or permitting if not his own decree? If he's not restraining and permitting the free will of man, then he must be restraining and permitting what he has decreed for the man to do. And that just doesn't make any sense for God to restrain what he's decreed or to permit what he's decreed. What makes sense is for God to restrain or permit the free actions of creatures. And so to even use the word restrain or permit is a concession of what we understand as the libertarian form of freedom of the will.
So he's come up with this, well, not he, but he utilizes this argumentation that it was necessary to blind people's eyes and to deafen their ears to accomplish the cross. And then once you've got that, then you don't have any of that type of stuff anymore. So...
okay, so are you disagreeing that he's hiding it from their eyes, lest they crucify the Lord of glory, as Paul put it in 1 Corinthians 2, 8 and 9? Because that's all you just said there, that he's hidden it from their eyes. Well, how does he hide it from their eyes? According to the scripture, he uses parabolic language, spirits of stupor, other means at his disposal that he can hide these things from the truth of his identity from their eyes. Why else would he do that, if not to accomplish the crucifixion and the engrafting of the Gentiles? So it's not just accomplishing crucifixion. It's also bringing the Jews, the Gentiles into the church, establishing them into the body of the church.
This sovereignty of God thing and all those hardening and all the rest of that kind of stuff, that was just during that time. That's not going to happen in any other context. That's never happened. God has never guided history through hardening anybody else. Okay, you know, Pharaoh.
No, it's not true. We believe that God has a disposal now. He can harden people who grow rebellious today. God may use Bill Maher, for example, who is a very atheistic, agnostic, mean guy on television who shouts down Christians all the time. God can use him in his rebellious state to bring about a good purpose through Bill Maher. Can do that. He probably is doing that through ways that we don't even see and know about all throughout our world and life. That's why Paul warns the Gentiles. Hey, if God cut off his own people, the Jews, the natural branch, to accomplish purpose, don't think he won't do it to you too. Don't be arrogant to think that you as a Gentile people wouldn't be cut off from the light of the truth if you grow hardened to it as well. So he's not trying to steelman me. He's trying to strawman me. He's not looking at my best resources and understanding what I'm saying. He's just guessing, oh, well, Leighton must mean that God just never does any hardening of anybody else for any other time, but just this one little purpose and one little time. And that's all he means. And again, all strawman, nothing here that's true about what I say.
During the ministry of Jesus, but now it's just all human autonomy 24/7 is what you're going
to
get.
He's not trying to draw everyone to himself until he accomplishes his purpose of redemption. Because imagine if 3,000 people became followers of Jesus, like happens in Acts after Pentecost, after Jesus was resurrected. If he had 3,000 followers, loyal followers, spirit-filled followers prior to the crucifixion, they would have never crucified a rabbi or a teacher with that many followers.
Okay. Now he's covering his face. If you can't see it audio wise, like just like rolling his eyes, just very, very upset here. Just ridiculous. What have I said that you wouldn't agree with? Is that not true? Is it not true that if 3,000 followers had spirit-filled followers had believed in Jesus and followed him and became followers of Christ and loved him while he was down from heaven, while he was here on earth, as John chapter 6 puts it, by the way, in case you forgot that John chapter 6 says down from heaven, that they wouldn't have crucified him then? Is that untrue? Again, facts don't care about your feelings. You're obviously feeling embarrassed by something I've said here. So explain to me now. This is why I want to have a discussion with you. I want to be able to say, James, why are you reacting this way to what I just said? We should agree with that. We should agree that obviously his strategy was not to send the Holy Spirit and the clear gospel proclamation calling 3,000 into faith prior to the crucifixion.
And followers, he would have an army, you know, defending him.
I'm sorry. When I heard this, I was driving, and I am very thankful for my Subaru. because my Subaru can pretty much drive itself. And so it can keep me in the lane. And I had the interactive cruise control on, so it's gonna keep me from the car in front of me and slam on the brakes if I need to. And I'm very thankful for my Subaru, because I listened to Leighton Flowers while I'm driving. This was almost as good as the choice meats illustration, because it tells you so much. We can't have 3,000 people choosing to follow Jesus, because they'll make an army. And then the crucifixion will never take. Once you abandon
okay, even if Calvinism is true, James White, even if we step into your world and say God elects them, they have nothing to do with their choice, okay? God chooses 3,000 to be saved prior to the crucifixion. They would not have crucified a Messiah figure or a rabbi even who have 3,000 spirit-filled loyal followers. Would you agree with that or not? Reasonable, guys, on the side check. Isn't that reasonable? Even for a Calvinist perspective, of course, he's going to wait until that's accomplished before 3,000 people, Jewish people, because he says, Peter, remember, he says, you're the ones who crucified him. So these are the ones who are crying out in the crowd, the streets. Give us Barabbas, crucify Christ. Many of these are the same people. They come to faith, okay? Filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues. You're saying strategically that would have worked, them being beforehand? Of course not. And yet you're rolling your eyes and making it sound like this is just so ridiculous. And we would never believe this. This is absolutely insane. Yet it's something I would think you would have to concede.
In fact, deny, and I would say to the point of detest, the sovereign decree of God. And there is no sovereign decree of God in Leighton Flowers' world. I think we all recognize that, hopefully by now. There is no sovereign decree of God.
No, there is a sovereign decree. Sovereignly decrees, as A.W. Tozer is famously quoted for saying by Michael Brown and many others who's debated you, he has sovereignly decreed not which choices we'll make, but that we'll be free to make choices, and that a God less than sovereign would be afraid to get that kind of freedom to his creatures. We believe in a sovereign decree. We don't believe sovereign decree means exhausted divine determinism. So we disagree with you that God has exhaustively, divinely decreed the decisions, thoughts, and actions of his creatures. That's what we disagree with you on. We agree there is sovereign decrees. God can decree whatever he wants to decree. Obviously, within his character and his nature, he's not going to decree or say something that's against his nature, like, hey, why don't you go kill children to Molech or something like that? He wouldn't decree that because he's good, and he wouldn't decree people to sin because he's a good, holy, just God.
Once you abandon that, this is what you end up with. Is Jesus can't have an army of 3,000 spirit-filled followers. What was at the end of John chapter 7 again? The Spirit was not yet given because Christ was not yet glorified?
I'm not sure what he's getting at. Maybe he's thinking that I thought that the Spirit came before Pentecost. I'm trying to say that God waited for Pentecost to come and for the Spirit to come down like fire and for 3,000 to come and to be filled with the Spirit. He waited until after the ascension of Christ for that to occur, after the resurrection. Maybe he heard something different. I've been guilty of that too. I have heard something different than what my opponent was saying. And when I listen back to it, I go, oh, okay, that's all they were saying. That's nothing to really object about. I've done that before. I'm going to just assume the best about my friend here, James White. He's just misunderstood me. I just put it that way.
All right, look, we've got an hour and a half, and there was still one more. Let me just jump down to this one really, really quickly. I'll try to be a little bit shorter. Because we went to Romans and Ephesians real quickly. He was brief. I will try to be brief as well.
Generally, predestination, it's one of those words, again, it's been packed with a lot of theological baggage, but really, when you break it down, it's a very simple term. It's destination is pre-decided or predetermined, okay? So the destination for who has been predetermined? Well, the destination of those who believe in Christ, those in Christ through faith, has been determined beforehand. So, for example, if there was an airplane flying from Dallas to Chicago tomorrow at noon, the airline has destined beforehand where the flight will go. Nothing there says anything about the airlines deciding who will and won't get on that flight. The airline simply puts out the advertisement saying anyone can come, anyone can board this plane.
Okay, so what you end up with in attempting to deal with Ephesians chapter 1, and we're not going to go back to that today. We've done it many times before. You can read Potter's Freedom and things like that. In Ephesians chapter 1, you have the assertion that the direct object of the act of predestination, the choosing of God, are specific people. We see this because of the fact that they are predestined. And as a result of being predestined, they experience the fullness of salvation. But the direct object of the choosing is not forgiveness, adoption, glorification. That would be this use of predestination, that you're choosing the ends. They will experience this. So God chooses that anyone who by their free will chooses, see, that's where you put it in over here. You enter, you're not going to get this out of Ephesians 1. You put it in over here. But what you do is
Okay, so not obviously James White never exegetes Ephesians chapter 1 because he's not doing it here. See what I did there? I took he actually said, go to my website and look at where I've gone through this text before. I'm giving him the benefit of the doubt. You should actually do that. But if I treat him like he's been treating me, then that's what I would say. Well, he doesn't exegete Ephesians chapter 1. Obviously, look what he's doing there. And that's part of the problem. You've got to look at the whole of somebody's work and be willing to do the homework to figure out what is their exegesis of a text that brings them to use these analogies and the things that they do in these short little podcasts that he's a guest on and doesn't have time to go through the full chapter and give an exegesis of it. And so in the same way, we're gonna ultimately give him the benefit of the doubt and say, yes, he's done exegetical work on Ephesians chapter 1 before, as have we. And if even on the podcast, Brian Wagner and I walked through Ephesians chapter 1 verse by verse pretty clearly. And we've already debunked this from John Piper, who ultimately says the same thing, that it's this concept or idea that they think that we don't believe that the individual person is being chosen. And that's just not true. We believe the individual believer has been chosen. What has he been chosen for? He's been chosen to be made holy and blameless. It's not an individual believer being chosen to be made a believer. That doesn't make any sense, which is the mistake that John Piper made. Remember, we kind of slip a tongue, had ultimately believers being chosen to be believers. When the truth of the matter is, it would be a lost person before he's ever born being chosen to be a believer, to being chosen to be in him, versus those in him being chosen to be made holy and blameless, something that is a part of our sanctification. We're going to be made into the image of Christ. We're going to be adopted, which is a part of the glorification of our bodies, where the redemption of our bodies. We're eagerly awaiting for our adoption when he takes us up to be with him, as Romans chapter 8, verse 23 says. It's something we're eagerly awaiting for our adoption to be completed when we take up residence with him. So these are things that God has destined beforehand for those who are in Christ Jesus. And that's how we interpret Ephesians chapter 1. He interprets Ephesians chapter 1 to be about individuals being chosen before they're ever born for reasons not revealed to us, according to the intentions of God that are secret and hidden, that he has picked some people for salvation, the rest he has passed over, and this he does to the praise of his glorious grace, which is made manifest in time through the playing out of this script, I guess, of the decree of God, by which everything happens exactly as he has decreed for it to happen.
It's not a sleight of hand thing. It's the move the cups around and where's the bean and the cards thing, and it's all done for theology too.
Again, sleight of hand assumes evil intention or a misdirection, like I'm intentionally trying to mislead my followers. I don't think that James White's doing that. I think James White is intentionally trying to lead his followers to believe truth, and I would hope that he believes that about Michael Brown and others who interpret Ephesians 1 the same way that I do. And it's just unnecessary to do that to your brothers. He doesn't even say things like that to Muslims. And so I'm not sure why he would say that to a brother.
But what's being said is, what's been predestined is that those who believe will be conformed to the image of Christ, will be adopted, will be forgiven, will be all these other things, indwelt by the Spirit of God. So this is the idea that you want to communicate. And a reformed believer who has become reformed through doing sound exegesis should not find this to be any kind of meaningful argumentation. This should be eye roll, really, type of argumentation. But there
so,
are people.
So he's instructing you as Calvinist how to react to other exegetes who disagree with your Calvinism. You should eye roll them. You should just throw them out. Oh, this is stupid. This is dumb. In other words, he's teaching you to be like him. In the response, that way you don't have to really deal honestly with them. I would say it would be better for you to deal with me like some of the other Calvinist friends that we've had on the program. They treat me with respect. They are cordial to me. They are loving towards me. And they give me the ample opportunity to ask them questions and me to do vice versa. They don't roll their eyes at me. They don't mock and belittle, those kinds of things. That would be a better, I think, example. You don't need to do eye rolls and dismissal kind of comments when you're talking to Calvinists, or Calvinists, you shouldn't do that when you're talking to non-Calvinists. I don't think that's helpful in the body.
People who have become reformed through less than appropriate means, or look, you can...
You become reformed through less than appropriate means that God decreed for you to become reformed. So God decreed for some people to become reformed through means that are less than appropriate. Why?
You can become reformed. God can draw a straight line with a crooked stick. But you should want to become grounded as quickly as possible, even if your introduction was not the most long-lasting way of being introduced to Reformed theology. You know, if, you know, I know people who were introduced to Reformed theology by people now that they go, I can't believe I listened to that guy. But, you know, back then he was saying some good things, and they've matured and realized, look, the only reason to be Reformed is because you're convinced that that's what the exegesis of the text consistently applied, using the same methods of hermeneutics across the board, consistently teaches.
Right. And all of us should use consistent exegesis hermeneutics across the board on every single text. I unequivocally believe that. And no matter how many times you misquote me out of context in your debate, won't take that away. So just keep that in mind.
Rather than going, yeah, no, I don't. I use a different methodology for soteriology, a different method. No, once you realize,
I don't use a different methodology for any of the other perspectives. And I've already explained that to you numerous times. So to continue to say that is misleading your audience purposefully.
If that stuff doesn't work, then any of the superstar things should be laid aside. It's not because superstar preacher JP or JM or RCS or the other RCS, all of those things should be laid aside. And I am convinced of this because the text says this, because it's right there. This is the consistent way of understanding the text, and I'm using the same methodologies. So
yet for the first 400 years of the Christian church, nobody understood the text this way. Facts.
When you get with Ephesians chapter 1, this whole definition of predestination is lost. Or Romans 8, as we've demonstrated. But the direct object of this divine act are individuals who then experience these things, but the individual...
And he thinks we disagree with that. He thinks we disagree that the object are individuals. We believe the objects are individuals too. We just don't believe that they're individuals chosen for no apparent reason before the world began to be made into believers. We believe the individuals are those who put their faith in Christ. He doesn't address it. He's been dealing with us for years on this topic, and he still doesn't get that. It's baffling.
Individuals are the ones that are chosen. Is the final glorification of the elect a part of God's sovereign decree? Of course it is. But what Leighton Flowers wants you to do is to believe that what he has predestined is just simply that anyone who will believe, and I'll leave that up to everybody else, will receive glorification. That results in an impersonal concept of atonement, union with Christ, adoption, forgiveness. It all becomes impersonal.
Why impersonal? Okay, think about this. Let's objectively look at both sides, okay? Why is my side impersonal and your side is personal? Your side believes that God has selected individuals before they have a name, before they have a face, before he's created their name or their face, or has decreed all their actions and their beliefs, before all of that, before anything about their personhood is even established, and without regard to anything about their personhood, he has chosen certain people. Okay? So that seems pretty impersonal. If it's not taking into account their name, their face, even before the name in their face exists, that seems very impersonal. And all their activities have been ordained. It's prior to all those things that he's making this choice of them on your view. On my view, he's choosing a broken, contrite, pigsty-smelling sinner who's coming and saying, woe is me, I can't do this anymore. Please have mercy on me, a man with a face and with a name and with a history and all my baggage. And God saying, I choose to have mercy on you, Leighton Flowers, a horrible, wretched sinner. I am going to merit you not because you believe, but because of the work of my son. I'm going to put it onto your account graciously, even though you don't deserve it. Which of those two is impersonal? Let's take it out of the whole Calvinism debate. Let's take it out of the whole thing. Let's say there's a man and a woman in a relationship, and one of them, before they ever meet, just gets a phone book, doesn't regard name, doesn't regard face, and says, this one's the one I'm going to love. I'm not going to take into account what they look like. I'm not going to take into account what they say or do. This one's the one I'm going to love. This one's it. Versus the one gets to know somebody, learns all their faults, learns all their quirks, learns everything about them, and chooses to love them for who they are and know them for who they are. Which one's more impersonal there? Which one reflects more of the Calvinistic perspective of God choosing people before they even have a name or a face and without regard to their name or face versus him choosing those who have a name and a face in their pigsty moments of life? You be the judge. Again, objectively speaking, you be the judge.
Because what you're saying is God has chosen to forgive and adopt a nameless, faceless group, and it's all up to us as to who that's going to be. Even though Ephesians 1 says...
Nameless and faceless. Unconditional election means your name, your face, and anything about you is not taken into account. It's prior to you having a name or a face, literally. And yet he accuses us of having an impersonal election. Go figure.
He chose us in him. Not he chose a plan in him that we...
Again, we agree with that. He chose the faithful in Christ. He chose those who have faith in him, those who are in him through faith. He chose them, the individual. He chose James White in him. Okay? That's personal, isn't it? What did he choose James White in him for? To be made holy and blameless, to be conformed to the image of his son, to be adopted, meaning being redeemed or being brought up to heaven with him, which is what Romans 8:23 describes it as. All the spiritual blessings that God destined beforehand is for James White, because James White put his faith in Christ Jesus. And when did he put his faith in Christ Jesus? According to verse 13, when you heard the message of truth, when you believed, you are marked in him. So when you believed, you were marked in him. You weren't marked in him before the foundation of the world. You were marked in him when you believed, according to Paul. So I have to go with Paul there. You were marked in him, not before the foundation of the world. You were marked in him when you believed, when you heard the message of truth.
We then voted ourselves into. That's not the same statement by any stretch of the imagination. But that's what you've got in quote-unquote provisionism and the perspective that it presents to us.
Okay, that's the end of it. Brenton is a Calvinist that posts here quite regularly, and so I saw one comment from him I want to pull in here. I agree that James White often caricatures Flowers. Good. We have a point of agreement. So it's painful watching Flowers respond with caricatures as well. These guys need to get together and hung out. So his first sentence I agree with, and his last sentence I agree with. We do need to get to James White does caricature me. We agree with that, and we do need to get together. I've invited him on the program. I've invited to come onto the program dozens of times. It's been unreciprocated. He doesn't want to do that. So let's look at the middle statement. It is painful watching Flowers respond with caricatures as well. Okay, I asked at the beginning of the program, please point out to me specific times that I mischaracterize Calvinists. And I meant it. I mean what I say when I say it. And I listened to SideChat. Unlike what you saw there on James White's broadcast, if you didn't notice, right there at the bottom, live chat is turned off. Live chat is not there. He doesn't listen to us when he's playing these things. He doesn't do that. Okay. I do, because I want to hear what you're saying. I want to learn. I don't want to be caught in an echo chamber here. So Brenton, if you have some time here, you may have already left. I don't know if you're still there. If you can give me a specific of what I said that caricatures James White's version of Calvinism, I would be glad to learn. And for my mistakes, if you can go ahead and put that in the side chat, I'd appreciate that. And looking through the rest of the side chat, I see a lot of great comments because we've gone for almost 3 hours now. James White was just an hour and 10 minutes off about how long we would go. I wanted to try to engage with some of the side chat. It's one of the reasons our broadcasts do go long, is that I actually engage with people as an opposition with, Brenton earlier does have a post. Maybe this is what you're referring to, Brenton. God knows the names and faces of people he's saving. Again, I agree. On Calvinism, he knows the names and faces. I didn't say he didn't know them. I said he doesn't take them into account. I said he chooses them prior to them existing. Because remember, it's by divine decree that they have a name and a face. So prior to them having a name and a face, God chooses that person. So actually, he's not really choosing the individual. He is choosing to create an individual for the purpose of being his elect, for the purpose of these things. And so to say that God knows the names and faces of people he is saving, not disagreeing that he has all eternal knowledge on Calvinism, he would know what their name is going to end up being because he decrees what their name is going to end up being. He knows what their face is going to end up looking at because he decrees what their face is going to end up looking like. He also decrees what every action they're going to ever do in life and every desire they ever have in life. He decrees everything prior to them existing on Calvinism. So he's choosing ultimately to create somebody to be this name and to be this face and to be this kind of person who acts the way that they do prior to the foundation of the world, prior to creation. Unless, I guess there could be, depending on the lapsarian perspective, order of decrees, that maybe God decrees their name and their deface and their actions, and then he decrees his choice of that person despite their name, their face, and their action without taking that into account. I don't know. You can clarify that for us. He is not choosing them based on anything in them. Okay, on Calvinism. Did I say anything contrary to that? If I did, point it out. Simply because he wants to show mercy on them. Okay. Again, I don't know that I said anything, and you're not obviously on that comment. You're not saying that I did say anything different than that, Brenton. But if I did say something that is misrepresenting you, please give the timestamp of what I've said that's caricatured, misrepresented Calvinism, and I'd be glad to look at that. So I appreciate that. Okay, here's a rebuke. He kind of looks like a bully I had in high school. Leighton and James, two little children eternally feuding. Guys, get over it. Start acting like a little more mature. Could you imagine the apostles acting like little kids? Again, this is, I appreciate your comments. If I've acted like a little child in this broadcast, then, let me know. I've tried to call out where I believe James White has made mistakes. I don't believe that I've acted immaturely in doing so. If you have specifics on that, I would appreciate it. But if you don't like the program or you don't like the content that I'm choosing to do, then there's a little switch on the side where you just go click and you can watch something else. That's just a suggestion. You have free will if you want to watch something different than what's on right now. It's always fun to listen to those kind of comments. All right. David says, I have disagreements with both Leighton and James, but still love them both. Absolutely. And I think you should love James. And I love a lot of what James does too. I like a lot of his work. I don't like particularly how he deals with us, but I do like a lot of his other work. Brenton replies, okay, I was wanting to give Brenton enough time to reply. That isn't impersonal. You said that unless God does it because of their faith, because of something in them, then it's impersonal. It isn't. Okay, so what I was actually replying to his accusation of us being impersonal, okay? So what I was trying to say is, if you really compare these two, which one is more impersonal than the other? I wouldn't really want to try to call Calvinism impersonal, all right? Because that's a little bit demeaning and it's kind of slandering the person. It's just saying impersonal. I think there's probably in Calvinism a personal aspect of God's election. I don't think it's more personal than ours. I think it's less personal than ours, given that the person isn't taken into account. You just now said it yourself earlier. The name and the face of the person isn't taken into consideration. The actions of the person aren't taken into consideration. Therefore, it's by definition not personal. Okay. It's arbitrary by definition. As we've even looked at Jonathan Edwards uses the word arbitrary will of God in choosing who he chooses to save. And so that's what I was trying to do is just to say, in contrast, if his accusation of me being impersonal versus his view of impersonality, that's what I was trying to refer to. Somebody's making Ishmael realize that, Peter refutes, Paul and Peter have a disagreement among believers in the New Testament. Christians can disagree with each other. Matter of fact, there's nothing wrong with disagreeing with each other. Husbands and wives will disagree with each other. Learning how to disagree in a mature way is important to continue to have dialogue and to continue to act like Christ. And so Christ disagreed with people. He confronted people, Peter and Paul, disagreements, the Jerusalem Council, all about a disagreement among the church. There's nothing wrong with having disagreements among saints. It's how you do that. Can you do that with respect to one another without misrepresenting the other? I think that's important. I understand you were replying to him. Brenton says that was my original critique. Neither of you is impersonal. Okay. So you're trying to say neither of you is impersonal. I was saying Calvinism is at least more impersonal in that it doesn't take the personhood of the person into account when making the choice, whereas our perspective does take the personhood into account, namely the person's willingness to not rely upon their own personhood, to say, okay, I am no longer relying upon my own effort and means of saving myself because I can't. Therefore, I'm putting my trust in him. And on that basis, God chooses to show grace and mercy to whom he wants to. There's nothing impersonal about that. Is there any others? Is there any others, Brenton, where I've caricatured, you seem to indicate that James White, almost an equivalence, like James White caricatures me in the same way I caricature him. This makes Eric Kemp pretty much set. So Eric Kemp is sometimes my apologist, and he comes around and on the Facebook, I've seen him do this pretty hard, where he comes down on people pretty hard for trying to equivalent, kind of make equivalent, like I'm doing the same thing to James White as he's doing to me, when I really go out of my way to try to represent James White as kindly as I can, and graciously offer for him to come on the program and to express our perspectives together. So that kind of equivalence is sometimes frustrating, because I think there's a clear, obvious distinction between how we each deal with these things. There it goes. Eric, I put up the Batman signal, and there Eric shows up showing that the two sides are not equivalent. That's very true. I think it's pretty obvious that the two sides are not equivalent. There's some more back and forth here. I could go on forever reading some of those, and it's coming on the 3-hour mark. And if I go over the 3-hour mark, they're going to be relentless, and they're teasing of how long we go. So God bless you guys. Love y'all. Be good.